Houston Gamblers and the Tampa Bay Bandits. It's 80 degrees around Tampa Bay. The beaches, a lot of folks out there enjoying the sun today. And some say this is a prime opponent for springtime football. But at Tampa Stadium, we're expecting a crowd close to 40,000. And the Bandits figure to be busy trying to handle the run-and-shoot offense of the Houston Gamblers. Hello again, everybody. I'm Keith Jackson, along with our analyst, Lynn Swan. And, Swanee, let's talk about this run-and-shoot offense of the Houston Gamblers. To me, it looks like a covey of quail coming out of a bush when they come off the ball. What about it?
Well, they look like that, but they make me mad. I'm jealous. Actually, I'm envious. As a wide receiver for Pittsburgh, we ran the ball most of the time. But these guys, they throw the ball all the time, and it's a receiver's dream. It's like your birthday every day. It's a gift. Now, last year, Richard Sanders led the league with 115 catches, and his running mate, Sanders, had 101. And they didn't stop right there because last week, they just took off in that record-setting game by Kelly. Look at the statistics. Touchdowns, passes, three people over 100 yards in that passing game. Hey, I'm making a comeback. It'll be in Houston.
Well, they have fun with it. There's no question about it. I think it keeps the morale of the team up. But at the same time, you take Tampa Bay now, bandit ball, as they call it. They play that for fun, too.
But that's just what bandit ball is. It's having fun. It's kind of like little things you do in the park when you're playing football. They'll have the offensive team come off. The punting team will go on. They look like they're going to punt the football. Then the offense will sprint back out there and try another play. Last year, against New Orleans, the Breakers were there. They tried two onside kicks in the first half when they didn't have to. That's fun football.
Well, there's some folks around this neighborhood who have been preoccupied all week about figuring out a way to stop this run-and-shoot offense. Of course, Steve Spurrier, the head coach of the Tampa Bay Bandits, is on the field right now with our colleague Tim Brent.
Well, Keith, you're absolutely right. I have to believe that you all have been talking offense. You've been thinking defense most of the week. How do you stop Jim Kelly? What do you do defensively?
Tim, I don't think you're going to stop him completely. What we got to try to do is keep him out of the end zone. And what we got to do is stay on the field some offensively. We can't go out there and throw three balls and come off. We've got to make some first downs and not score in a hurry and try to stay on the field and keep it out of his hands.
So much of their offense is based on the read. Post-snap read, really. The receivers actually read the defensive backs. Do you show them a lot of different looks, mix things up defensively, zone, man, combo?
Well, you do so much, but really you just have to sort of be patient, lay back, try to give them some short throws, try to knock the ball loose out of their hands, hope he overthrows some. Just try not to give up the big one right now is what we're sort of thinking.
Former quarterback, former great one, offensively, very innovative coach. Can we see some new wrinkles today?
Well, I hope so. I hope we're moving the ball and staying on the field where we get a lot of opportunities to utilize a lot of our ball plays, but that just depends on how we're going. Hopefully we can do it.
You weren't happy last week with the offensive production. I know John had a rough night. What have you done this week to overcome that?
Well, we've practiced a little harder on throwing and catching, Tim, running correct routes and so forth, and if John can get off to a good start, his confidence seems to build with him, and that's a big key for us, so maybe I need to give him some ball plays he can hit early.
All right, Steve, good luck today. All right, Keith, back up to you.
And we're just about ready to go as referee Tom White has had the captains of the respective teams, and there is number 12, Jim Kelly, the league's MVP a year ago, and the way he has started out in 1985, he wants a second MVP ring because it was a remarkable week that he had last week, coming off a remarkable year as a rookie. So Jimmy Kelly, who came out of Pennsylvania, and he was recruited by a lot of folks, but those folks talked to him about being a linebacker, playing defense, and he said, uh-uh, and he went off down to Miami, and you know the rest of the story, I'm sure. Houston has won the toss, so we will see the run-in shooters with the first possession of the football. The temperature, I would think, will be around the mid-80s down on the field. They play on real grass here at Tampa Stadium. Clarence Verdin, will be the receiver and return man with Zenon and Brusician kicking off. Verdin's number is number 89. Position, of course, does the place kicking and the punting. He's been around a long time. He came originally to this country out of Canada on a track scholarship at UCLA. He was the Canadian national champion javelin thrower. born, however, in Ginsburg, Germany. So we've got two foreigners, or two ex-foreigners, who are doing the kicking here today. Of course, Tony Fritsch is the other. Oh, it's an onside kick by Tampa Bay, and the scramble in the middle of the field, and Houston comes up with the ball. So there you go with your bandit ball. And Houston will open up with Jim Kelly at quarterback. The offensive front will be busy trying to protect him as Houston will come out. They'll line up with Sam Horrell in a single back offense, and then you'll see these other two backs move up into what amounts to a slot back, Ricky Sanders and Richard Johnson. Gerald McNeil will be a wide receiver to the left side most of the time, and Scott McGee, number 88, will be the other wide receiver. Up front, it's Kerr, Usher, Khalil, Rosada, Robinson. So here we go with the black shirts from Houston. Kelly's going to put it up. Looks and looks and looks and goes deep with it down the sidelines. They're out of bounds. The pass is incomplete. It was picked off by Warren Hanna as McNeil was out of bounds long before the football arrived. Defensively for Tampa Bay now, you've got a three-man front of Mike Butler, Ron Simmons, and Mike Clark. And Clark and Butler and Simmons are good pass rushers. Nordgren will play in there some, too. With Harold Kirchbaum, Offis, and Johnson, the linebackers. Secondary is Alvin Bailey, Warren Hanna at the corners. And in the middle, two guys who've been around, Zach Henderson and Doug Bedoin, the two safeties. It is second down and 10 from the 48 of Houston. Kelly looking again. Goes the other way with it, and he's got Johnson. And Johnson fumbles the football as he goes down, but retains possession a yard beyond the marker at the 41-42, call it the 41 of Tampa.
That was Doug Bedoin who almost came up with that drop pass by Johnson. Johnson bruised his ribs last week in the ball game, and actually the cartilage between the ribs, so he's a little bit sore. Right there, loosely holding the football, he tried to switch hands, and it just got away from him.
Jack Pardee is the head coach of the Houston Gamblers. Had two coaching jobs in the NFL, and of course was a Hall of Famer as a player. From the 41 of Tampa, first down, Kelly drops again. Down the middle with it. Incomplete. Couldn't hang on. Ricky Sanders in front of Zach Henderson.
Ricky Sanders goes hobbling off the field. Coach told me once when I played for the Pittsburgh Steelers, name is Lionel Taylor, you don't have time for a five-yard catch. He's fumbling it. That's why we call it a five-yard catch. But right there, he's taken that low and flipped over. And because of that hit, he limps off the field.
And as we mentioned in the very beginning, Len, that's one of the penalties when you're a relatively small man taking the ball down the middle where those defensive backs can load up and whack you. Clarence Verdin is in now, replacing Sanders, and Kelly drops on second and 10. Goes down the middle with it under great pressure, intended for Johnson. The pass is incomplete. And storming in was number 58, Alonzo Johnson, and he rode Kelly down as Jim released it.
And during the preparation for this game, defensive coordinator Barry Wilson said there are a couple of ways you stop this run-and-shoot offense. One is to get great pressure on the quarterback, and that's difficult when you're rolling out moving all the time. The second is to be able to cover them like a blanket. And man for man, the Bandits can't match up with the receivers. But right here, the first alternative is the pressure, forcing Kelly to throw a little bit early.
It is third and 10 now. Rolls out, a little shovel pass forward, trying to get the ball to Sam Horrell, and the ball was short of where Sam was standing, and it'll go as an incomplete forward pass and bring up fourth down. Dale Walters out of Rice University averaged just under 32 yards per punt in the ball game in Los Angeles last week. Bruce Vaughn is the deep man for Tampa. The snap is low. Walters picks it up and knocks hits it well into the end zone and beyond the field of play. So it'll come back out to the 20. That's where the Tampa Bay Bandits will go to work after a 41-yard punt and no score. With Gary Anderson lined up behind him along with Greg Boone. Wide receivers are Eric Trevelyan, big target. Willie Gillespie is a little lame. Marvin Harvey, the all-league tight end last year and a good receiver. Mike Pitcock, Foot, Newton, and Smith up front. For Tampa Bay, from their own 20, their first possession of the ball game, and Reaves drops to throw. Gets it away to the sideline pattern, and it is incomplete. The pass was intended for Marvin Harvey, the tight end. Defensively for Houston, they open with Crosby, Hughes, Taylor, and Caton up front. The linebackers, the Hawkins brothers, Andy and Mike, Kiki Diella in the middle, and the secondary, Mike Mitchell, who just got here this morning, along with Calvin Eason, Luther Bradley, and Will Lewis. Of course, Luther Bradley was at Arizona a year ago, and Luther's been around a while. So there's good wisdom in the secondary, and up the middle goes Greg Boone. And Boone gets what appears to be a first down. He pounds across the 30. Mooney is 5'9", 195, low to the ground, and gets out of the blocks pretty quickly.
I'll tell you, one of the obvious disadvantages for the Houston defense right now is that they have to be very concerned about an outstanding running attack. Boone and Anderson both over 1,000 yards last year, and a strong passing attack. On the other side, Tampa only worries about the pass.
Reaves on a roll. Man wide open is Harvey. And the tight end's got another first down for the Bandits as he reaches the Houston 42. Mike Mitchell rolled him out of bounds. Mike had just came in this morning having come from his brother's funeral. His brother was killed in an automobile accident last week. So it's not a particularly happy day for Mike Mitchell, but he flew in to join his ball club. John Reaves played at Philadelphia, Cincinnati, Minnesota, and Houston in the NFL. Out for a time, and now has come back to play for the Tampa Bay Bandits. He's playing as well as ever. From the 42 of Houston, first down. Ball is handed to Boone, and Greg Boone gets it to the 38 for a pickup of about 3. Jose Taylor, who played for Bill Yeoman at Houston, in their defensive tackle, 6'4", 270, made the stop on him.
Steve Spurrier was somewhat concerned about Greg Boone coming into training camp. He came in well over his playing weight, so he's been checking out this young man every day to make sure that he's down to his right weight now. I think he's at about 197, I thought he said earlier.
Reaves back. Little short pattern. The pass intended, apparently, for Gary Anderson coming out of the backfield, but he was well covered by the middle linebacker, Kiki Diella. That's a couple of fellows who bumped helmets before when Anderson was at Arkansas and Diella played at Texas. Number 15 standing there alongside Steve Spurrier as Steve signals in the play is Jimmy Jordan, backup quarterback.
Go back on the option.
Let's call it to 39. Make it a pickup of 3, 3rd and 7. Houston got caught in the neutral zone, and you're going to get an encroachment call against the Gamblers, unless somebody moved alongside the line of Tampa Bay.
I don't think so. Offside. With the little jump off sides, number 59, Andy Hawkins, came in from top of the screen there and just got John Reaves as he released the ball. Made him pay a price anyway.
So the penalty moves it down from a third and long to a third and short. They need 3. And time called for just a moment by one of the linesmen on the sideline.
We got timeout on the rail.
What he's doing, maybe moving some of the players back out of that neutral zone. So the chain gang can get up and down the field with a little more freedom. Third down and three now as John Reaves brings the Bandits up to the ball and give it to Gary Anderson outside. Oh, he got a great block by Greg Boone. A tremendous block by Boone. Open the door for him. And Anderson goes for the first down at the 20.
Greg Boone came to the outside and had excellent position. We'll take a look. Gary Anderson takes a pitch. That's Boone out in front of him. He makes the block to the outside. Doesn't knock the cornerback down. But what he does, creates a lane for him to run through.
And the Bandits are cooking now at the Houston 20. Runs into Mike Hawkins. There's a heck of a collision at the 16-yard line, but it's a pickup of 4 yards.
Steve Spurrier came into this game wanting to control the football. A nice balanced attack. Didn't really want to score very quickly because that would only bring out the Houston offense again. And the Houston offense
inside Lonnie's
goal is to score about 37 points a game. But with a balanced control offense, Spurrier can get the points on the board and eat up the clock.
360! On second and six, Reaves throws. Pass good. 5 yard line. Caught by Eric Trevelyan. Trevelyan at 6'4, 205. Big target.
Caught that one over Adrian Simpson. Now you watch Reaves will drop back the pass. He's going to get tremendous pressure again from Andy Hawkins, the linebacker, number 59. Hits him as he throws. But Trevelyan is standing right there waiting for the football. Now, if number 21, Adrian Simpson, had seen the football and decided to go for that, he could have cut in front of Trevelyan, Keith, and picked that one off.
But instead, it's first and goal from the five, and Anderson has it. Looks for the corner, gets there.
Had said just after last week in his tremendous game of 143 yards that he felt extremely comfortable. He was due for a good year. Wasn't happy with just getting 1,000 yards in the last game of the 1984 season. He feels he is due to break open many ball games in 1985.
He can do a lot for you.
Oh, yes, he can.
And position in for the extra point, and it's good. 41 to play first quarter. Tampa Bay Bandits take the ball at their 20 and stick it in the end zone.
That drive took 8 plays and 3 minutes and 46 seconds. And that's not the fastest drive, but again, taking up a little more time than scoring on 1 or 2 plays, which is to the advantage of Tampa.
7-0. The Bandits break on top. Gary Anderson has now scored 5 touchdowns in 5 quarters of play in this 1985 USFL season. That's a heady pace.
The young man feels comfortable. He wants to go for it this year.
This time, Anderson hits it, knocks it all the way to the 1 yard line for Clarence Verdin. Verdin finds a little daylight, but there's a penalty flag lying in his wake as he comes out to about the 21. There's one penalty flag back up field, and then one down around where the first block was thrown.
James Ramsey, or is it Ramey? Just check that. James Ramey, number 78, was offside on the kickoff. And I thought the second flag was thrown because Ramey got down the field so quick, he was in block from behind.
On the kicking team, penalty is accepted. 5-yard re-kick.
Referee is Tom White. The umpire is Marvin Durenberger. The head linesman, Jeff Bergman. Line judge, Buddy Ujeski. Back judge is William Lang. Side judge is Joe Richwine. And the field judge is James Anderson. There are the stats on the first touchdown of the day as Tampa Bay goes out to a 7-0 lead. And the ball is brought back to the 30, where Anderson will kick it again. There's a little breeze down on the field, so it's quite a comfortable setting for the players, and most comfortable for the fans. Jack Pardee, went through some agony last week in Los Angeles as his team fell behind 33-13 in the fourth quarter.
That hat he has on his head is to cover up all the gray hairs he's acquired from watching Kelly in the comebacks.
Here's the kick by Zeno. Good one. Goes down to the six. Verdin again. Verdin gets to the outside. He's gone. No flags behind him. It is 94 yards. Touchdown. Now, wait a minute. It's too early for those kind of heroics.
Well, not against this team. Keep in mind that all the receivers for this team run about a 4-5 or a 4-4 in the 40-yard dash. Clarence Verdin is a backup receiver on this ball club. And if Ricky Sanders or Richard Johnson's can't play, he'll be a prop, play a prominent role as a receiver. Here, he just gets downfield, picks up great blocking, and is not even touched. That's poor coverage, Keith.
Yes, 5'8", 160 out of Southwest Louisiana. Tony Fritsch is in for the extra point try. It is good. Tony, in his warm-ups last week in the jumping jacks, pulled a muscle. Now he says he'll only exercise his hands during jumping jacks. Ready for the kickoff now as Dale Walters comes out to hit it. Fritsch doesn't do the kicking off this year. Tony, the portly character from Austria, he really is more fun to watch him play the game of football and be around him than anybody I think I've ever known. He has a good time. Here's Walter's kickoff. It's very short. Going to let it bounce in front of him, and coming up to pick it up is number 34, Bobby Futrell. And Futrell gets a short run out of it. Verdin's run of 94 yards for the touchdown ties his own personal record of the USFL. He had one against Jacksonville last year, and here he is with Tim Brandt.
All right, Keith, it ties your record, Keith just said, with the long one you had last year. Tell us where you saw it open up.
That's my first 10 steps. I saw the execution on the left side was great blocking. The hole was there, and it was me in the kitchen. I know it was one-on-one. I can outrun him.
You told me you run a 4-2. Is that true?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Good day, I might run better. Like hello to my mom.
All right, Swanee, if you believe that one.
I believe him. I believe him.
4-2?
I won't race him.
Tampa Bay goes to work from the 22. Ball is given to Gary Anderson, and he is caught behind the line of scrimmage. Run bound by number 59, Andy Hawkins.
4-2.
Yeah.
Must have been on AstroTurf or a track, spikes on.
Pretty fast. I know that four of the receivers have been timed at 4-4 or better. So I know that's so.
Yeah.
Second down now at about 12. The ball back near, just inside the 20, near the 19. Boone and Anderson are the setbacks for the Bandits. Double wide. Reaves will throw. Short. Anderson shakes a man. He's in the middle. Gary Anderson shows you some moves. Good for a first down up to the 36. He ran right around Andy Hawkins, and Andy Hawkins is a pretty good linebacker, folks.
Some classic defensive strategy going on here. Reaves came up to the line. They showed them blitz. He audibled out of it, but he still had a man open, and Gary Anderson into the flat. Defense had dropped off at the last moment, creating the opening for him, and then Gary Anderson turns it into his own individual show. Excellent moves here.
17 yards on the pickup as Reaves goes back to throw. Good protection for John. Goes short with it. Hits his tight end, Harvey, and he's wrestled down just short of the 40.
Before he was wrestled down, Keith, he dropped that ball. That's one of the problems when a player is struggling for those last 3 or 4 yards, a second and third effort, because so many players have broken tackles. You don't want to blow the whistle very quickly on a strong tight end or running back. You give him a chance. At the same time, it gives the defense a chance to hit that man more often.
Better wrap it up. On the 40. Second down, 6. Reaves throws a little swing pass out intended for Gary Anderson. Anderson, but Kike Diallo, the middle linebacker, number 31, looks like he's taking Anderson on now as his personal project, because he was in the backfield and was right there. Had he been aware the ball was coming that quickly, Kike might have had a shot picking it off.
The only reason why he didn't look in the backfield is because he was in man-to-man coverage. They had that coverage across the field, so when Anderson took off to the side, that was Diallo's assignment. He took off after him to make sure he wouldn't catch a screen pass and or have a cushion should he catch a pass.
A 7-7 ball game. Tampa Bay went 80 yards to lead, and Clarence Verdin took it 94 yards on the kickoff for a touchdown, and that's where we are at 7 as Reaves rolls it right. Finally throws it downfield, and it is intercepted by Andy Hawkins. Was he inbounds? He was inbounds. So Andy Hawkins, who had 8 tackles and 1 sack last week, starts out having another big day today. He played college at Texas A&I.
That time, John Reaves really should have gotten to the ball. You see the pressure on him right there. The receiver hadn't even turned around. He really should have thrown that out of bounds, because all his receivers were pinned to the sideline.
John had been better just to tiptoe on out of bounds and eat it. It's a turnover instead. Family day in the sun at Tampa Stadium. Kelly Kirchbaum, the inside linebacker on the left side, has that tiny little microphone in his helmet today. So we'll be hearing the signal calling not only of Kirchbaum and the defensive people, but obviously Jim Kelly at quarterback. And now here he comes up to the line.
Good day.
Kelly on a drop. Goes down the middle, pass is caught, and good at the 32-yard line by Gerald McNeil, who is playing with a sprained thumb. Now, Gerald McNeil played at Baylor at 5'8", 140 pounds. He thinks he can play defensive tackle. The kid doesn't know anything about fear or danger, and watch him. At 140 pounds, goes right down the middle.
If you're at 140 pounds and you go down the middle, you either have to think that positively or be crazy.
Come on,
I don't think he's crazy.
He sure is fast and tough. From the 32, it's a first down for Houston.
Tee him.
Again, it's in the middle and short to Clarence Verdin, and Verdin gets to the outside, and he is thrown out of bounds at the 23. What speed will do for you now, because the little guy in the middle in traffic had the speed to drop off, give up 2 yards, and still outrun the pursuers and turn it into a substantial gain.
He also knew, Keith, that because of the play, that there was nobody else on that backside. All the receivers were on the left of the field, and it was an open field if he had drilled back to his right.
They're measuring for the first down. Verdin is in the ball game now because Ricky Sanders, on his first play today, apparently has sprained an ankle and may have some trouble coming by. No, it's a knee. Knee problem. So Ricky's got ice on the knee, and he's in some pain. First quarter score, which might get your attention. Denver Gold out in front of Birmingham, 7-0. That's the other run and shoot offense in the USFL. Mouse Davis is now over there. June Jones, who went with him after helping him put in the offense in Houston last year, made a comment a couple of weeks ago that one of these days some team's going to throw every play of the game. Well, so far Houston is on that pace. Second down and about a half a yard. Kelly going to put it up again. Goes down the middle. He's got Johnson inside the 5. First and goal at the 4. Caught the ball in front of Dwayne Anderson.
Now, there were some doubts as to whether or not Johnson would play. But yesterday, when I talked to him, when you talked to him, said nobody's going to stop him from playing in this ball game. He's here. It's a big ball game. Passes have to be caught, and he intended on being the number one man on the football field in that responsibility.
Louis Louis!
Rich played his college ball at Colorado. First and goal from the 4.
Chris Rogers!
Kelly still throwing. Coming across the middle, it's touchdown for Richard Johnson. Kelly getting good protection, hung in the pocket, waited for somebody to break out of the pack. It was Richard Johnson, and the Houston Gamblers have gone back to the lead.
Well, when this passing team gets into scoring territory so deep, anywhere inside the 20, you have a better chance at covering them because you don't have as much room to run. Kelly does a good job staying open there, waiting for his receiver to pop open. Johnson was on the far sideline. Things got hot. He just came across the middle.
Interesting, too, Swanee, that he touched the ball to Johnson. He just touched it. Didn't throw it hard. Gave him a chance to catch it. He didn't always do that in his younger days. He used to break ribs and fingers. The extra point try now by Tony Fritsch is good. He was the USFL scoring leader a year ago with 130 points. Here's your touchdown play.
Here's another shot of it. Soft pass because the receiver is not that far away. That was not as tight a spiral as Kelly can throw. It still does the job.
Jim Kelly now has hit four passes in a row. Fastest growing areas in the country as the Houston Gamblers cash in an opportunity. The interception of John Reaves, and they went right downfield with it and scored. There's Smokey.
He wanted a pay raise this year.
The horse?
Yeah, they didn't give it to him.
High kick goes to Steve Carter. Carter gets a little room and comes out across the 25 to about the 26. First down from near the 27-yard line. Anderson, and no daylight on that side as Gary wiggles in there now for about a yard. Let's spend a moment as Tim Brandt talks to Jim Kelly.
We're here with Jim Kelly. Jimmy, tell me about the reads out there. I knew you told me the receivers have to read as much as you do.
They sure do, and they're doing a good job at it. I'm getting some time, and that's what I like. It's a matter of going out there and executing and doing what we're supposed to do.
Have they done anything defensively that you didn't expect?
Well, they're showing us exactly what we looked at last year, coming with the same thing they did to us last year.
Okay, Keith.
Last year, Tampa Bay won 20-17. It is Greg Boone carrying on the quick opener, and Booney comes up near the 34, so they'll be looking at a third down here in about 3 yards.
We were talking about this a little bit yesterday, Keith. The defensive team of Houston is coming up giving a strong blitz read to John Reaves. And then he comes up, he starts calling his cadence, then he quickly starts an audible. Now, a defensive linebacker can pick up that change, then he counters with another defensive formation. And they're forcing plays against a defense that John doesn't want to run against.
Looks like the San Antonio defense. Everybody's up on the line of scrimmage, and they're definitely showing blitz on that one. And all of that movement by the defense and a checkoff by John Reaves, and the clock runs out.
Called tactical football. Tactical football where you have the personnel on the field who can take command, take control. You talk about a player being a general on the field or like having a head coach out there. You have a linebacker that can pick up when a quarterback is audibilizing, changing the play at the line of scrimmage, he can change the defense.
Houston yet to run the ball in the game. Right now, Tampa looking at third down and about 7.5 with Joel Blunk in the backfield now, making his first appearance of the day. Reaves gets the ball off just as he is hit by Andy Hawkins. Hawkins coming from the blind side, got there just before John Reaves turned it loose, and that brings on Zenan in position to punt. Sometimes I feel, though, if you just go ahead and run the play you've called, let the defense do all that jumping around that it wants to.
That's what they tried to do there, Keith. They thought that maybe they didn't want to play that defense, a quick count, and take advantage of it. But they were set, and they were coming after them.
And position's kick. Tight spiral. Long. Way back. McNeil. He gets away. He can fly.
He's gone. He's gone.
No flags. Touchdown, Houston. Boy, what a bunch of rabbits. Man, can they run.
The fans fans are booing, but there are a couple of Houston fans up here in the press box next to our booth who are jumping up and down as number 13, Gerald McNeil, gives him a little bit of a Baylor flash. This hole is so big, there's just no way. There's just no way a player from this team is going to stop him. No one has the speed to catch up to him. He's gone.
I'll tell you one guy that wasn't going to catch him is Zenon Andrzejczyk. That's like me, like Tony Fritz trying to catch somebody.
Well, if this continues, Jim Kelly will get a vacation. He won't be on the field.
Fritz's kick is good. At 2:41 to play now in the first quarter, Houston has jumped out to a 21-7 lead. Here's a look at one of these guys that can give you a 4-3, but I thought the coverage was pretty loose here.
The coverage was loose. It was a long kick, a long punt, Keith, and he actually outkicked the coverage. And then combine that with the fact that Gerald McNeil made a great move, catching that punt over his shoulder, spinning away from the first man, then the rest was history, because no one was around to cover.
So Verdin goes 94 yards with a kickoff return for a touchdown. McNeil now goes 79 yards to tie a USFL record for a punt return and a touchdown. And just like that, it's 21-7. Heavy rides the burden on John Reaves.
This is where a coach begins to get more gray hair, Keith. When you get a team like Houston and you've got to play match-em.
Six for a first down, but let's see about the penalty. He was pretty much alone, too, when he caught that ball.
Holding, number 31, defense.
It is against Kiki Diella, the middle linebacker for Houston, so the play will stand in Tampa Bay now with some room to work.
Tampa Bay is catching Houston, playing a lot of man-to-man coverage, and what they did was send the receivers on a crossing pattern. Eric Trevian just caught it on the move. Just continued his pace towards the sideline and upfield.
2:05 to go in the first quarter.
Let him give it to you.
Anderson. And coming across from the side, defensive end Cleveland Crosby brought him down. And if Cleveland doesn't get a hold of him, Anderson might well have popped out of there and it'd been a foot race to the corner.
I think we're going to see more of Anderson in this ball game playing a factor, as Houston has people trying to key on him, but in a man-to-man type of defense. You spring him one-on-one, 5 yards downfield, he's almost a sure bet to get you an additional 10.
Larry Brodsky, number 82, is in now, replacing Courville at the wide receiver spot. Give the ball to Anderson again. He gets a kickout block on the right side, and on second down and three, he picks up 5 and a first down.
Keith, with a minute and 3 seconds on the clock running down, it's important to note that the game plan for Tampa is to control the ball and use the clock. Now, they're behind 21-7, but it's only the end of the first quarter coming up, no time to panic. So you're not going to see them change their game plan at all. They will continue to do the exact same thing.
Well, you had the turnover, the interception off Reaves, and then the two kick returns. Otherwise, it's a tie ball game. Anderson coming across, has the ball on his hands, but Mike Mitchell coming up from the left corner nailed him as the ball arrived and Gary could not hang on to it. Mitchell out of Howard Payne, developing into one of the better corners around.
Spencer Jackson was also open on that sideline, just standing there. I don't think John saw him. Or maybe, and because he didn't see him, he didn't see Mike Mitchell sitting back there waiting, because Kiki Diella was a man covering Anderson on the play. Kiki might be a little worn out following him all over the field today.
That's right. Second and 10. Reaves back. Short, incomplete, off Anderson's hands. Gary was looking for a place to go because he could hear the thundering hooves of Diella and just simply couldn't pull it in.
Hosea Taylor was also coming in on number on John Reaves. You see the play action here. Right there, I think his concentration is just not with him because he should have made this catch. It just bounces right through his hands.
So the Bandits are looking at third down and 10 at the Houston 45, trailing the Gamblers 21-7 with 33 seconds to play in the first quarter. Sideline pattern by Reaves. Pass is caught, but it's well short of the first down. Eric Trevelyan back in the ball game, making the reception in front of Will Lewis. Will Lewis, the right corner for Houston, had a great season last year, but playing right now with a troublesome groin pull.
Keith, you mentioned the fact that John Reaves doesn't throw that hard of the pass. Right then was the time he needed to burn one in there. That one just came floating in there. Almost got his receiver hurt.
Killed. Quarter's over. So after one period in Tampa, the Houston Gamblers out to a 21-7 lead over the Tampa Bay Bandits. Tampa Bay now faces the dreaded experience of having to punt the ball. Gerald McNeil, who went 79 yards, and
Bandit ball.
Here comes Bandit ball for you. Timeout called by Houston as the Steve Spurrier switch. His team, his kicking team was out there. All of a sudden, the offensive team comes running back on the field, and the Houston Gamblers said, wait a minute, timeout.
Yay!
We're not going to put up with this nonsense, and it was a good move by Jack Pardee.
It was a very good move. I don't know which player on the Houston defense called the timeout, but he did the only thing he could have done to save his defensive team from being exploited by the quick move of the offense running back onto the field for the Tampa Bay Bandits.
Well, Steve Spurrier, who's got a bag of tricks, I'll tell you, he'll try anything. Because he'll look you right in the eye and say, my owner, John Bassett, told me Bandit ball was supposed to be fun, and by George, I'm going to have fun with it. And he does. Going to go for it on fourth down and 6.
Well,
the ball at the 41 of Houston.
He made a decision to go for it, tried to go for it and surprise everyone, but now the element of surprise gone, he is still going to take his chances.
Well, he opened the ball game with an onside kick and almost got away with it. But Houston took it at midfield and 48-yard line and couldn't do anything with it in the first possession. Fourth and 6, they're going. The 27-yard line, Spencer Jackson. Spencer from Florida, a Gator.
Now, watch this coverage. There are two receivers going out to your right. There are two people on the man-for-man and the safety over the top. This safety is waiting for someone to break to the inside. But what he does is doesn't break to the inside. Spencer just turns around on the hook, and Reaves anticipated the move and fired it in there.
The 28 of Houston, first down Bandits. Short man up front is Boone, and Booney is inside the 25, spinning to the 22. That's about 6 yards.
Didn't look like he had a hole or a place to go when he got to the line of scrimmage. He twisted around a little bit, picked up a good 7.
Not seen the ball yet today for Houston, but right now the Gambler defensive folks are out there thrashing around trying to stop the Bandits. 21-7 Gamblers lead. We're only early in the second quarter, and this is Gary Anderson slashing in there and stopped short of the first down. He was really nailed as he came to the 21 by Hosea Taylor. Jose looks pretty trim. He's down to 270.
Looks very good. They are obviously keying on Gary Anderson, trying to take him out of the attack. Plus, he was the only person in the USFL last year to be in the top 10 in three areas, scoring, receiving, and
rushing.
He's out as a wide receiver right now. They give the ball to Boone. And Greg Boone punches in over the 19, but short of the first down. So they'll bring up fourth at about one. And here are your first quarter stats.
Look at that. I mean, Tampa Bay leads in all areas except for the score. But no rushes for the Houston Gamblers. And they have a lead 21-7. Now, their touchdowns came on possessions of 30 seconds, a minute and 40 seconds, and the last punt return by Gerald McNeil only took 11 seconds.
Travel 79 yards, including going across the field.
With pads on.
Timeout's called now by Tampa. The Bandits spend the timeout at 12:33 to play in the first half, and they're trying to get closer. The Denver Gold continuing to lead Birmingham 16-7 in that ball game. Another score, the Arizona Outlaws 7-0 over San Antonio in the second quarter of play. It'll be Gary Anderson, left side on this play. Fourth and one. How do I know that? I was eavesdropping. Well, he may have it, but it's close because Kiki Diala, the middle linebacker, filled that hole like a falling tree, and it's just a matter of the spot for Anderson and the Bandits on fourth and 1.5.
Gamblers are walking off the field as if he doesn't have it.
That might be presumptuous because it looks like he got a pretty fair spot on it. He had to go inside the 18. Nope, he's short. Short by half a yard. So it was Diallo who made the defensive play that stopped Gary Anderson. So the Bandits now will have to play some defense as Kelly and company comes back on the field. Two of the Houston touchdowns scored by the kick returners. Verdin, 94 yards on the kickoff. And McNeil, 79 yards with a punt return.
Troops right, Roger!
Kelly Kirchbaum, right there, wearing that tiny little mic in his helmet.
Steve!
All stay on the defense as Kelly swings it out to the right side, and for the first time today, Sam Hurrell, the lone running back, handles the ball, and when Sam goes out into the pass flow, he becomes the fifth receiver.
That's correct. When you heard Kelly yelling, stay, stay, defensive people have what we call checks. When an offensive team goes in motion, it changes the formation. So the defense has the option of staying in that defense or checking to something else. That time he said stay because we don't want to check out of our defensive coverage for this man going in motion.
Louis
is the call for the defensive alignment.
Shows
you five-man.
Played
a heck of a horn. Kelly is back and hands it off this time to Harrell, and Sam, trying for the first down, is going to be held about a yard short. You get Sam Harrell into a circumstance where he's got a little room to work, and he's a tough guy in the secondary. You get him past the line of scrimmage, and he's rough.
Last year, he had a game, carried the ball 19 times, gained 200 yards, was injured, and Todd Follow came in and ended up being the leading rusher on the team that year.
Third and one. On third and one, Kelly wants to throw it and does, and it's good for the first down to Harrell. So instead of the conventional play where you'd give the ball to a running back and he'd stick his head in the stack, he stood around back there for a good 8-9 seconds before he finally found somebody to throw, and now Kelly has completed six in a row.
And Kelly was looking way downfield for a receiver, didn't happen to notice number 83, Vince Courville, who was on the far sideline, all alone, no one on him.
Of course, they've got so many guys out. They got five guys out. It takes you a while to find all five. Takes the defense a while, too, sometimes. Johnson, the man in motion, and Kelly's pass thrown underneath. It goes to Clarence Verdin, and Verdin is in there for a maybe two-yard, three-yard pickup as Alonzo Johnson stayed with him and brought him down.
Well, he actually had about a 6 or 7 yard gain, and then trying to avoid Johnson, he gave ground and was tackled. One of the problems of having so much speed, we talked about the asset of it, being able to run away from people. That time, he thought he could do it again, gave ground and got trapped by it.
One of the things about this offense that Mouse Davis fathered,
Roger,
is there's a goodly amount of patience in it, too.
It's a complete system.
Richard Johnson tiptoes out of bounds about the 49-yard line. Tim Brett now with John Reaves, the Tampa Bandits quarterback.
Yeah, offensively, you're getting what you want. You're moving the football up and down the field, but you didn't get all the points. It has to be frustrating right now.
It is a little. We got stopped up short there on 4th and 1. We needed that. Now we got to get back on the field and get a touchdown before half here and hopefully go in 21-14, maybe better.
All right, John. Keep it going. Keith.
John, as you saw, the stats from a year ago had a big ball game against Houston. At midfield.
Go to Roger.
It's first down. Hand off to Harrell. And Sam gets over to about the Tampa Bay 48 before Fred Nordgren, the nose guard. Fred in now in relief of Ron Simmons out of Portland State at a year up at Toronto. It'll be 2nd and 8. And that's who? Ricky Sanders. Hope that knee's not bad. We can see those things. Oh.
Go to Roger! Roger!
Roger defense. Kelly looks, pumps, brought down behind the line of scrimmage by Fred Northman. Kelly was only sacked twice last week by Los Angeles. Last year, over the season, Kelly was sacked 82 times. So he's acquainted with the Bermuda.
Well, he personally was sacked 75, and the team was sacked 82. What you're not seeing right here is so much going on this football field. On the far side of the field, he got a matchup you would not believe, Keith. He had 3 receivers on 2 defensive backs.
But didn't have time to deliver.
Didn't have time to look.
That's right.
Forward.
Loss of 6, 3rd and 16. Sideline man wide open is Vince Courville, and Vince has a first down for Houston on the Tampa Bay side of the field. Courville is out of Rice, 5'10", 165. He made a tough touchdown catch last week in that fourth quarter comeback against Los Angeles.
See a semi-roll by Kelly. He wants to see the whole field, just a little hook route. But if you don't think Vince is looking for a place to run, he just turns, spins, trying to find a little alley for that little burst of speed and quickness to get by the defenders.
Kelly has now hit 9 straight. First down Houston at the Tampa Bay 35. Pitches the ball off to Harrell. Penalty flag on the near side of the field. So let's see about the penalty as Sam picked up about 4 yards.
It may have something to do with the motion, Keith. The motion man may have been going towards the line of scrimmage.
Or it could be a hold on a defensive back on the side. One of the things that you have to do when you're playing a cornerback there, though, Swanee, it's going to be against Houston. Tampa Bay is going to decline it, apparently.
Legal motion. Offense. Second down.
He did turn upfield too soon. You have to give him cushion, though. You just cannot go up there and play him head up. You can't do it.
Well, you can't play these young men head up because they're so quick and fast. Some people you're going to have to play head up to throw them off the timing of their route. Unfortunately for the Tampa Bay Bandits defensive secondary, they're playing well as a unit, but they don't have the individual speed to stay with people who run 4-4 or 4-2.
They give Harrell 2 yards, 2nd down and 8 now. Kelly's pass. short and incomplete, intended for Verdin, defending Alvin Bailey. Alvin Bailey became quite a story last year when he was the punt returner for Tampa Bay. He had some 90 consecutive punts where he disdained a fair catch. He brought the ball back. Well, now he's moved up and played so well in camp and in the first game that he's taken over the left corner job, beating out Jeff Jordan.
Now he has to take on, in the true running attack, he has to take on some pulling guards.
Yep.
And only a man with that kind of attitude can play on defense.
That's true. Third down and eight. Pressure, but Kelly gets it away, and the pass is incomplete. The ball short hopped. Richard Johnson. So Kelly knew that pressure was coming. He could see it, two of them in front of him, and he could hear the one coming from the blind side, so he let it go quickly, and he missed his man. So you're looking at fourth down at about eight.
Tampa Bay has to be very happy, very pleased at this point with the way their defensive team is playing the Houston Gamblers.
Now they got to saddle up and face a fourth down here, fourth and a short eight. And McNeil to the left side.
Different kind of football, Keith. Fourth and eight, and they're going for it.
Kelly's pass down the middle. It is
caught.
Did he hang on?
Yes, he did.
Call the ambulance. Sam Harrell makes a great catch in traffic and takes a whack, but holds on as he is pounded down to the turf at the 13.
Well, folks, you've probably heard it 1,000 times, but you're going to hear it one more. If you're going to be a receiver and go after a pass, you might as well catch it, because no matter what the outcome, you're going to be hit. So you have to make it worthwhile. Sam Harrell was in a no-win situation. He was sandwiched between people in the backfield. He was going to get hit, but he made the catch.
And Kelly lofted the ball into him and gave him a chance. On first down, Kelly Rose throws to the corner. Touchdown by Courville.
Right.
Timing play.
That's a bullet low to the ground. Defensive back was turned around, was not facing Kelly. He had no chance because he couldn't see the ball. And Courville, well, once the ball was within reach, all he did was make a little move to the inside, get down low, scoop it up, hang on to it for the touchdown.
Boy, I tell you what, Jeff George had him well covered, but Courville and Kelly know each other well enough now that they just timed it out and made it work. Rich for the point. Good. 5:22 to play in the first half, and Tampa Bay failing on fourth down. They pay for it as Houston leads now 28-7. Been defused as Tampa trails 28-7, and Houston will kick it off. Walters, a slow floating kind of a kick, and it's picked up by Bobby Futrell. And Futrell finds a little running room and comes up across the 35 near the 37. So the Bandits will have fair field position with 5:10 to go in the first half. They need some points now. Minutes and 4 seconds in that, is that right? 13 plays, 82 yards?
13 plays, 82 yards, three running plays in that particular drive, the only
That's
three of the ball game for Houston.
The reason I'm expressing a bit of a start at it, that normally, it's abnormal. They don't hold the ball that long normally. Here's John Reaves, sideline pattern, almost picked off. Good coverage by number 35, Mike Mitchell, as Reaves tried to work to the sidelines to Eric Trevelyan. Mitchell just made a good play. Ball is at the 36, second down and 10 for Tampa Bay.
Play a snapper rider now and get the grass kicker free. Nobody down and no limit for 90 days.
By Reaves. Down the middle with it. The pass is good at midfield. Caught by Larry Brodsky. Brodsky out of Miami. And Larry never was the fleetest of the fleet, but he knows how to run a pass pattern.
Always described in his college and professional career as a good possession receiver. a Fred Biletnikoff type.
Oh, I remember one game between Miami and Notre Dame that we did in the Orange Bowl a few seasons back. Brodsky had a sensational day.
Brodsky didn't have a bad day the first time I saw him play when he was with the Generals, opening game of the inaugural season for the USFL.
It's first down, Bandits at midfield. Defense was jumping around. John Reaves had checked off, and the defense had stepped right into the path of his checkoff, and he spends the timeout with 4:06 to play, 28-7, Houston. Looking at the last ratings, I would say Nelson's one up at least on Billy Packer. Ball at midfield, first down. Tampa Bay's got one timeout remaining. Houston two, 4:06 to go, first half.
Great, Connie Wheel.
Little play action, trying to set up. Anderson on the other side has one man in front. Gets a good block. And Anderson sprints for a first down as he reaches the Houston 38. Vince Courville, one of the speedsters that we saw catch a touchdown a moment ago, is with Tim Brandt.
Keith, and these guys are having a ball. Now, the last time Tampa Bay came out on defense, they came out with six defensive backs on you guys, and they were playing man. Do you like that?
I really like it. You know, it gives us a chance to just go man on man, speed on speed. And on that particular touchdown, we had a choice call whereby I had the option of running the post or the out, and he gave me a cover two look, and I just ran the fade. Special K threw it to the spot.
All right, Keith, he says there's not a defensive back in the league that can stop him.
You might be right. Little short pattern here to Greg Boone, and Boone is close to another first down for Tampa Bay as he gets inside the 30 near the 28. So that's a pickup of about 9 yards on the reception by Greg Boone.
Keith, hey, did you hear what he called Kellen?
Special K.
Special K.
I would agree, would you?
I got a feeling he means that more than an inch and Kelly can get it in.
Well, sometimes you can take an offense like this. You got to have the people who believe in it and work in it until they get it right. And obviously these people have done just that. Second down and one. It is Boone for the first down. So Greg Boone will give Tampa Bay a first down just short of the 26-yard line where Van Hughes brought him down. Mooney from Duke, Van Hughes out of Southwest Texas. Played for Jim Wecker. Big Van.
I think he might be short. Reaves came over to the sideline and was saying, motioning that it might have been short by a few inches, but the official said, no, first down. Kelly's a little relaxed about right now.
Here, so his eyes get a little wide open when he gets on the field. Oh my goodness. He hits his tight end Marvin Harvey right on the numbers, and Marvin trying to set himself for the shock to come with a hit he was expecting. Didn't control the ball. Oh, it wasn't Harvey, Brodsky. It was Brodsky.
Yeah.
Brodsky. You know, when you're in that posture, though, if your back turned to that cornerback, you just have to anticipate collision. And it hurts sometimes.
I've seen receivers in that position, Keith. They think someone's right on their back. They make the catch, and they're braced for a hit. And they're waiting there for 5 seconds because no one's around.
And then they fall down.
Far out of bounds.
Yeah. Second down and 10. Up. The Houston defense, the jumping defense, got him again. And Reaves didn't like what he had called or didn't like the personnel he had on the field. And so he spends the last Tampa Bay timeout at 2:50 to go first half. Little man-made breeze cooling off Jim Kelly. I'll tell you, somebody else who's having a fair to middling day here is Vince Evans. Denver has gone out over Birmingham 23-7 in the second quarter. Evans now, 39-yard touchdown pass and a 48-yard pass. But he might be catching on to Mouse Davis's scheme of things, too, as John Reaves is hit from the back just as he tries to throw by Jose Taylor, and it falls incomplete.
Earlier in the ball game, Reaves came over to the sideline on that fourth down play when Anderson tried to get the first down and didn't make it. They called it 16 at first and decided not to go that way because Hosea Taylor was having such a great ball game. And right now he comes in from that last play. He came in from behind to put the pressure on Reeves, forcing the bad pass.
They called him Jose when they were talking about it on the sidelines a while ago. If he keeps it up, though, it'll be Mr. Taylor by the third quarter. He's got a first down inside the 15 at the 14. Caught it in front of Will Lewis.
Watch player.
Not fancy.
No, not fancy at all. He very seldom will drop a pass that's catchable, even in traffic.
So precise with his patterns. First down from the 14. 2:11 to play first half. He wanted Brodsky to swing inside of Lewis, but Lewis wouldn't let him get inside, and it was a timing play, and there was no way that Larry could get to it.
He just wanted Brodsky to get more downfield, anywhere he could.
Right.
Lewis just had him faced off. He couldn't go anywhere downfield unless he ran over Lewis, and they would have dropped the flag on him.
He was trying to spin him inside, but you know, Lewis didn't have a particularly good game last week. In fact, they took him out of the ball game. Troubled as much as anything by the groin pull. That's a very difficult thing to play with when you've got to move quickly in all directions. Second and 10. Whoops, Houston got caught in the neutral zone. It must have got back. There's a flag finally, but the strike down the middle. Touchdown for Spencer Jackson. There's two flags. And I think it will go against Houston for being in the neutral zone.
John Reaves waving his hand as he comes off the field after talking to the official, finding out that it was against Houston, the penalties.
So at 2:01 now, the Bandits put their second touchdown on the board with this play.
Now watch Spencer Jackson after he makes his catch. He believes he's going to get hit, so he is really not going to move. He's bracing for a blow, but they miss him. Lifts his head up and sees the end zone's only 3 yards away. Jogs in.
Yeah, the Houston defenders knocked each other off, didn't they?
Yes.
The kick by Zeno Andrezicion is good. And it's now a 28-14 ball game, and here's Smokey.
And there goes Smokey. Smokey doesn't come out in the field for too long a period of time. Take another look. John just doing what he intended to do, straight drop that passing.
He zipped that ball right by the umpire's ear, didn't he?
Yeah, he better duck. He better
That's
duck
a good way
time.
To get a black eye.
John didn't have the greatest ball game last week, only completed 6 passes. During the preseason, he was in there for 5 possessions, scored in all 5 of the possessions he was in charge of. And even with the bad game last week, they still came away with a great win. Right now, he is 12 out of 23 for 161 yards.
There's the young man that caught it, his second of the year. Bandit defensive people have got to muscle up here and try to hold Houston and go to the clubhouse. Getting that touchdown, very important, but it won't mean a thing if Houston comes boom, boom down the field.
Well, their offense scored on 2 drives, one of 52 yards in a minute and 40 seconds, and their second drive came in 13 plays, 82 yards, and 7:04. So they've demonstrated in this ballgame the ability to do both, score quickly and possess the football.
This is Scott McGee returning this one. Another one of those wide receivers, and he pops into the open and almost got out of there. Whoa, out to the 46-yard line. I thought Scott was gone.
I was sitting on my stool here, Keith. I saw him bounce through. I jumped up. I said, oh, no, not again. We'll take another look at it. He doesn't get the same great blocking that Clarence had early in the ball game, but he finds a hole big enough right there. He fakes out the kicker. Scott McGee. They dangerous.
He can travel with it, too.
This team does not have a single tight end on their roster, the Houston Gamblers. All wide receivers.
Houston's offense has produced 143 yards. The return yardage for them so far, 211.
No.
The Gamblers have two timeouts to work with now at 150 to go in the first half and pretty good field position, I'd say, to start with, their own 46.
Whomever is the coach in charge of special teams for the Tampa Bandits, he is going to have a lot of time to work on it the following week.
Well, everybody doesn't give you the problem of the Houston
Roger,
short pass caught by Harrell, and Sam is out after about a three-yard pickup. That Denver-Birmingham game now with 3 minutes to go in the second quarter. The Denver goal 26, Birmingham Stallions 7. Whoa. Not only got their run and shoot going, but somebody's playing some fair defense to hold Birmingham to 7.
That's right.
At the 49, followed a three-yard pickup, second down 7. Kelly quickly to Clarence Verdin, and Verdin, with his speed, again, not that big, 5'8", 160, but he is so bloody quick that he's very close to a first down.
He felt all those big bodies around him. Quickly went down to the ground. A wise move. That young man might be around long enough to play some great football.
They'll bring the chains in to check it at 1:39 to play. 28-14 Houston leading. If I were playing this team, I believe I would like to. Oh, it's just short. I believe I'd like to have about a 35-point lead going into the fourth quarter. And even then, I don't know that I would be complacent. Impressed by the Memphis Showboats in their opening game against San Antonio. Pretty good looking team. They're going to get John Corker back, the linebacker. They'll have Tim Spencer healthy in about 2 weeks, the running back.
They have one of the better defensive teams in the entire league with Reggie White from Tennessee anchoring their defensive line.
Third and inches, and they're going to throw. Kelly going deep with it, and nobody there. It should be picked. Oh, my gosh, he dropped it. Warren Hanna literally became the wide receiver, and Hanna just flat dropped the ball. Gerald McNeil was going downfield, and for some reason, McNeil got hung up and was not near the ball.
The play, Kelly was looking for a receiver on the far side. Now, you see him, he overthrows him, but McNeil, the reason why he slowed down was because he was looking for Kelly to start scrambling. If Kelly were to scramble, his assignment is to come charging back to him. Now, if Kelly had scrambled or held on to the ball, McNeil would have come back to him and would have been wide open.
Yeah, there was a lot of real estate. No white church in it. There's your first down as Sam Harrell carries it down to about the 37-yard line of Tampa Bay. And the time remaining, 1:22. In the USFL, the clock stops for the movement of the chains, but once the chains are down, the clock is rolled by the referee.
Houston didn't have them.
But all day, now he's in trouble. Number 79, Mike Clark, kept hand-fighting his way, and Kelly had used more than his allotted time in scanning the field for receiver. And finally, Mike fought his way on through and brought him down for a loss, and the loss is back to the 45-yard line.
That's Jack Pardee on the sideline with the lead of 14 points.
Houston calling time. They have one remaining.
Kelly was looking downfield for the big one. Didn't want anything short. 6 points.
Hey, failure! Where's the team spirit?
Second down and 17.
That obviously is one of the players off on the Houston pitch. He knows that Spurrier really can't hear him.
I don't know. It might be just a leather-lunged fan.
That could be.
No kidding.
wide open. It is Vince Courville, and Courville goes for the first down. It needed 17 yards. He got 18.
Gerald McNeil took down Bobby Futrell, the cornerback on the play. Had he been able to get to the outside, he would have found the sideline clear and could have scooted down that sideline for a possible touchdown. You see the catch right there. Look at McNeil right there.
Kelly back on first down. Looking, looking, looking. A lot of time. In the end zone, the man is knocked down. Or he's fell down. Well, Courville is hollering that I was knocked down by Jeff George, but there was an official right there, and it looks like Vince may have twisted an ankle or hurt himself. He's coming up gingerly and trots off the field. So I guess he just, when he made his cut down there, had a cleat catch and twisted his ankle. I'm not sure that the Houston side's aware that he's coming out of the ball game because number 89, Verdin, is going to the sidelines. Richard Johnson's coming back. Do they have 11? Yeah, McGee's in. Scott McGee. Second down and 10. And Jim Kelly, looking around, didn't like what he saw.
1 second on the 30-second
clock. And with only 1 second remaining on the 30-second clock, could not get the play off, so he spends his last time out.
Would be devastating, Keith, to the Houston Gamblers to have two or three of the receivers go down to injury.
Yep. Well, Sanders is gone with a knee. He's in the clubhouse with ice on his knee.
Richard Johnson still has the bruised cartilage between his ribs.
They traded Greg Moser. He's with... We know who it is now, but
and if Courville is hurt, we'll make it a long day for the run and shoot, possibly.
Ball is on the 26-yard line. Courville has a twisted knee and has indicated that he thinks he'll be able to play more today. But right now, Tampa Bay being beleaguered by this Houston offense. The ball is at the 26 with 53 seconds to play in the first half. 28-14 Houston leads, and Tampa Bay trying to keep him out of the end zone. Down the middle, McNeil. Corner, it's Johnson. And no chance for Richard that time as Bobby Futrell was all over him, and he was getting some help from Zach Henderson, the free safety.
Johnson was in between the corner and the safety. Pass thrown by Kelly. Was thrown to his outside and high. He didn't really have an opportunity to get up in the air and turn for it. That was excellent defensive coverage.
There's Tony Fritsch
inside.
So if they don't do something on this one, Tony may get a kick to close out the first half. He's becoming quite a restaurateur in Houston. Oh, he's opening another one. Kelly back. Oh, he's got a man in the corner over here, wide open, and the ball is fumbled down the middle, and Tampa Bay has covered it. Apparently, they're going to know that. I don't think that was a completed pass, and here comes the man from the side now who is waving it off, isn't he?
Keith, I'll try to interrupt you, but I think right here is where, if they don't call it a fumble, that Steve Spurrier should exercise his prerogative and challenge that play.
Well, let's look at it. Tampa player is very upset over it. I don't know, just at first blush, I didn't think, he had it.
I think he is. He's talking to an official on the sideline right now. An official's going to go out.
How does he have it? Yeah, looks like, I guess he does have it.
Looks like possession.
That's number 88, Scott McGee, who was walloped. And Spurrier has the right of challenge because there goes the red flag. They've called it. And remember now, the use of the instant replay in this case. And the review official is the head of officiating in the USFL, Cal Lepore. And he's got to work with what we're working with right here. And the question is, did McGee have the ball? Was it a fumble? And the rule, the replay rule, rests only with the status of the ball.
And since this does apply to the status of the ball, there's 39 seconds. You do not want to give Houston the ball back.
That's a fumble.
Range. He had possession of the ball.
Absolutely a fumble.
1 foot coming down.
James Harrell knocked it loose. I think it's a fumble. Now they're talking. He's talking to Tom White, Cal LaPorte, and they're going to make their decision. But just a little note on this, that in the opinion of Cal LaPorte, it's got to be black and white. It's got to be obvious. Well, it looks from where I'm sitting in my relatively uninformed position that it was a completed pass and a fumble, and the ball came loose when Harrell hit him. And then Alvin Bailey finished it off. So if that's the case, Tampa Bay will have the football.
Here comes the official onto the field. Comes back. It's an incomplete pass. Timeout is charged.
Doesn't have any anyway.
He doesn't have any, so there's a penalty for calling a timeout when you don't have one. The ball is moved forward 5 yards.
Well, that was the first real call this season where it could have been effective, but it wasn't. So the ball now is on the 21, where it's fourth down and five for Houston. 38-yard field goal try by Tony Fritsch is good. So Steve Spurrier loses his appeal of the ruling. And at 35 seconds to go in the first half, the venerable Austrian comes onto the field to kick a 38-yard field goal and make it 31-14.
See, since this rule is using the replay is so new, Cal LaPorte is right next to us in the booth at halftime. I'm going to ask him what his interpretation of that was. So we have a better understanding.
He had said last week and made it a great point of it that it had to be pretty much black and white. In other words, he's not going to question the judgment of the men on the field, and I can understand that.
We'll take another look at that judgment. It's caught. It's in.
See, that angle, you can't really tell. He conceivably could have been juggling the ball around, but from the other angle we saw, it appeared to me that he lost it when Harrell hit him. I mean, when Harrell hit him. We've got a Harrell on one side and a Harrell on the other, and it fell it the same way.
Hear this on the end zone camera. Possession, 1 foot's on the ground, the other foot comes down. He's flipped over, and the ball comes loose. It is a close call.
Ball skitters on the ground, picked up short by Tampa at the 24-yard line. Dwayne Anderson, and Anderson gets to the outside. Gets out of bounds with 24 seconds to play in the first half.
Well, with all the hype about the offensive teams of both the Bandits and Houston, we forgot to take that close a look. Well, people on this football team have not been paying as close attention to their special teams, their tackling and their assignments, and the special teams have played the most significant role so far in this ballgame.
Neither team now with any timeouts remaining. There's the time remaining in the first half. 31-14 Houston. Don't write Tampa off. They can move that ball themselves. Reaves drops back. Looks short. Has to go short. Throws to Greg Boone, and Boone is thrown down. Short of the line of scrimmage, about the 40. He had the snap at the 38. He lost 2 yards on the play. They can't stop the clock. Kika Diallo brought him down. So they've got to hurry to get one more play. Get there. 2-1, half's over. Didn't get it off. Didn't get it off. The crowd was making a lot of noise, and Reaves couldn't get the wide people to hear the play that he was calling. We've got a penalty flag down. It'll have to be on the defense in order for the half to be continued, and apparently not. It's against the offense because both teams are going to the clubhouse. And so, after the first half of play, here's Tim Brandt now with Steve Spurrier.
First thing I'm going to ask you, Steve, is about the challenge here.
Well, it looks like a guy caught it and fumbled. Got hit and fumbled, didn't he?
I'll tell you this. From our end zone angle, it looked like a fumble on the replay.
Well, I think everybody knew it was. I don't know why the refs didn't change it. But I don't know. They didn't change it. I don't know.
Steve, what do you have to do to get back in the ballgame? 31-14 against Houston.
Well, we got to play better on third and fourth down. Our defense has played well a lot of downs. In the third and fourth downs, we've let them hit some passes. And then offensively, we hadn't played very well. Had a chance to get some points right here. And John throws it to a guy and we get tackled. We're not playing very smart. Hopefully, we'll play smarter and play better next half.
All right, Steve. Stop. All right, Keith.
Thank you, Timmy. Well, it's a 17-point deficit. I'll reemphasize the point, and I'm not saying just to hype the second half. I just think Tampa Bay has the faculty and the people to get back into this ball game. Here's the play now as it comes down the middle to Scott McGee. He's hammered underneath by Harrell. Bailey comes over the top. It appeared to be possessed, but it was not called so. So, at halftime, here in Tampa Stadium, the Houston Gamblers lead by 17, 31-14. The Gamblers on top, 31-14, and here we go. Long kick, floating kick, hard to handle, picked up by Steve Carter finally. And Carter is short of the 20 as he comes back to about the 16-yard line, and there are your halftime stats.
Well, obviously, it shows Tampa Bay controlling the football or possessing the football longer, more yards. What you don't see again are the special teams play for the Houston Gamblers. It made a difference in this ball game, and also the great defensive play, really, Keith, by the Houston Gamblers in mixing up their coverages, making it difficult for John Reaves to get a read, having him audible out of plays, and so forth.
They're going to bring the kick back and make Houston kick again from the 30-yard line. The rationale to bring you up to date, if you were with us in the first half and saw the challenge of the call and the use of television replay, the rationale in refusing the appeal by Steve Spurrier was that Scott McGee had 1 foot down. When he was hit, the ball came loose before the second foot hit, so they ruled no possession, and it was easy to call. Well, that's a matter of defense. But that was the decision. And that is the fun part of it, because it one of the great pleasures of any kind of sports contest is the fact that everybody doesn't agree on something. And that's also one of the dangers, I think, of using television replay. This is Bobby Futrell. And Futrell pops to the outside and almost got himself some room to run. And Dale Walters, the kicker, was the man that ran him down and caught him at the 36. So the play over which there was some disagreement, obviously by Steve Spurrier, was a pass down the middle, Kelly to Scott McGee. And here is your... Well, to put it very bluntly, the television angle is not really sufficient, I suppose, to be absolute in the call. And the call was no possession. Here goes John Reaves now on first down from the 36. Overthrows his tight end, Marvin Harvey. And I think he had Harvey that time, because the big tight end, 6'3", 225, had his body between the defender and the ball.
Yeah, well, he had Harvey open, but Jose Taylor had John Reaves under pressure and covered. You'll see here, just as he releases it, he goes down. Taylor was a man who grabbed him around the ankles and pulled him down. And the 78 was Cleveland Crosby coming in from the outside.
Man in his middle 30s ought not be subjected to that kind of abuse. Here goes John back again. Goes down the middle with it. This time it is caught by Spencer Jackson. And Jackson has a first down. And a penalty flag comes out of the pocket of one of the officials on the field as the tackle was being made. And it'll be at least the 40 and possibly more. That could be a face mask.
Could be a face mask. Could be something for a spearing or piling on after the receiver was down.
Grabbing a face mask. 35 on the defense. First down.
Inadvertent 5-yard call goes with the inadvertent face mask by Mike Mitchell.
You see, Spencer's got the ball there coming across, and as Mitchell comes across to grab him, he grabs a face mask. Wasn't intentional, inadvertent, so it's only a 5-yard penalty.
And the ball moves down to a first down at the Houston 35-yard line. So the Bandits are moving it here as we start the second half of play. Reaves throws, penalty flag on the field as Harvey makes the catch and goes down at the 20. A Let's see about the penalty. If it's against Houston, then Tampa Bay is operating at the Gambler 20.
It'll involve Adrian Simpson and Eric Trevelyan.
Number 21 on the defense. Yep. Penalty is...
They declined the penalty on the holding call against Simpson. They'll take the play instead, which is good for the 20. And it's first down, Tampa Bay. They put it in the end zone here, and this thing's very much alive. Of course, Houston hasn't been on the field in the second half.
No, they haven't. That's the reason why they have better score.
Slips and slides down at the 25. That 390 call is a play that involves Anderson. He called it several times. Almost every time he's had the ball, it's been that 390 play after that time. One of the things, I guess, George Allen always ran his ground offense, the running backs. George ran him to the left a lot. And I guess a lot of people wonder why. And I've never really honestly asked George, except it just seemed obvious to me that George figures everybody else is right-handed, so he ran his to the left side, which causes the defense to be a half step off. Oh, my gosh, Brodsky is wide open and falls down at the 9-yard line. There are penalty flags on the field and may wipe that one out, but Larry was all alone and then fell down. He lost Simpson completely. Holding call is against the defense, so the play will stand.
John Reaves have a blitz to contend with. He's worried about that. He's going to get pressure. But when he throws this ball, he leads Brodsky out. Brodsky looked like he was going to continue going downfield. But Reaves just threw it out to the sideline. Brodsky broke off his pattern, came back, made a good diving catch for the first down.
First and goal now for Tampa Bay at the Houston 9. Anderson was out for a brief blow. He's back into the lineup now. And Brodsky comes off. Trevelyan comes back. Jerry Price, a second tight end, is out there. So they've got a double tight end alignment now.
4 seconds in the 30-second clock.
Gets it off. Gives it to Anderson. Gary Anderson cuts it to the 5.
To hurry with that play, Keith. When we came up to the line of scrimmage, they only had 6 seconds left on the 30-second clock.
5-yard line.
And in the first half, they used up most of their timeouts just to stop the clock to avoid the penalty.
Okay, 31 G's going to be.
is the play. I can't even begin to tell you what that is. It could be Boone.
It's going to go right between the guard and the center on the left side.
It's Anderson.
Oh, no.
Bounces outside with it and gets down to about the 2. Well, there was no place to go between guard and center. That door was closed. Mr. Diala had taken care of that.
Well, to tell you one thing, they don't have the same numbering system that I know about.
Jackson and Brodsky have come back into the lineup now for Tampa Bay. Brings Jerry Price, the second tight end, out of the lineup. And puts Brodsky at the top of your picture. Anderson is also out. Well, they've got Boone alone remaining back as they move Trevelyan into a slot. And Reaves rolls that way, throws Trevelyan. Touchdown, Bandits. So Tampa Bay comes out to start the second half, and they take the possession and just take it right on down the field for this touchdown.
It's a very well-executed drive, mixing up the run and the pass. A little play action here finds E.T. wide open. Houston Gamblers defense has been doing a great job.
And position who played soccer but turned into a head-on kicker, knocks it through. Make it a 31-21 ball game.
Well, this series, John Reaves just came out, called his plays, and executed. Didn't worry too much about the shifting and changing of the defense by the Houston Gamblers. The result was a long drive and a touchdown.
Reaves was 4 out of 5 on the drive, 58 yards, including 3 first downs. Well, hold your breath. After the touchdown march, Tampa Bay is going to kick off. And the deep man is Clarence Verdin, who went 94 yards earlier.
Steve Spurrier had a strong conversation with his special teams at halftime.
I don't think I'd kick it to him. They're not.
No. They kick it to the short man. It's picked up well upfield by Ricky Young, a linebacker. And Young will come up to about the 38, so Houston's going to get good field position anyway. But I wouldn't kick that ball to Verdin.
I would.
Wouldn't you?
Yes. Kick it high, get it downfield, kick it to him, and tell everybody on their special teams, if you ever have any hope of getting off special teams, you better stop it.
That's,
or else
that's
you'll be out there. That's right. Put the back to the wall. Yeah. I mean, the score of this ball game would have been 17-14.
That's right.
If they had stopped Houston from scoring on two touchdowns on special teams.
Darrell Clark is in there as the lone running back now for Houston as Kelly rolls off the snap, looks down the middle, and pulls it down. And the Bandit secondary did a good job covering up the receivers. Linebacker number 50, James Harrell, had dropped off and gone 25 yards downfield in the coverage. Tim Brandt now with John Reaves.
Keith, one of the big adjustments they made at halftime was you're going on a quicker count, John. It looks like you're just forgetting about what they're doing defensively.
Using a little quicker count and also a different series that gives us protection even if they come up in that all front up there.
You're back in it.
Yes, sir. We're looking for a good one here. We got to stop them here.
Okay. Keith.
Second down and 8. From about the 40. Kelly goes short. Pass is caught by Verdin. Verdin is caught out of bounds. They got him at about the 42.
Quick little move by Clarence Verdin, giving ground to get more room to run. But there was someone else coming up from the outside to keep the pressure on him. He went out of bounds and still lost yardage with the move.
Go for him.
Third and 7.
8-6-7, ready? Watch the screen now.
That's Kelly Kirchbaum.
Louie!
To the end zone, Gerald McNeil. Touchdown, Gamblers. He had his choice, McNeil or Verdin. They were both there, and actually, Verdin was alone down here.
I'm coming out of retirement. I want to be a receiver for the Houston Gamblers.
Now watch this. You'll see to the right, if you'll be able to see it or not, but to the right of the picture, the ball is thrown here to McNeil over there by himself.
Well, the defense
is Verdin.
Of Tampa was in a zone coverage, and it's a combination of McNeil's speed just getting beyond the underneath coverage to linebackers in the gap between the corner and safety. And Kelly shoots a pass down there with his arm and velocity that the secondary can't get to. And McNeil turns on the jets, runs away from the coverage, and he's in the end zone. It seems so simple. Take another look at it. You see Kelly firing it downfield, linebacker coverage underneath. Now, as a receiver, you have to have a great deal of confidence that every time you catch a pass, anywhere beyond 15 or 20 yards, you can have room to run and score.
Bridges' kick was good. 9:08 to go, third quarter, 38-21, Houston. Dale Walters will kick off for Houston. And the deep men are Bobby Futrell and Steve Carter. Third quarter at a track meet in Tampa. Hops it in the air, sends it toward Futrell at the 7. And back to about the 24. Plays.
62 yards, a minute and a half. Boom, boom.
Well, right now, John Reaves.
Draw. That means should be draw play. Probably Anderson. That can't get loose. If he'd been able to get past Van Hughes, he would have had some room. But Hughes knocked him up.
Low had me, damn.
Complete to Spencer Jackson, and Jackson is short of the first down by a yard or so.
Complete number 8, Spencer Jackson.
Third and
one, 2. Seems like all the receivers, Keith, once they catch the pass today, are giving up some ground in an effort to find some room to run. More often, they're getting caught for less yardage. But on that play, Spencer would have had the first down if he had just stayed there.
There you go.
80-yard on third down. Anderson's got the first down. There's a penalty flag. Luther Bradley made the tackle.
Offensive holding. 68.
Uh-oh.
Yeah.
Number 68 caught.
64, right tackle, right guard.
The right guard. Holding.
I got holding.
68 on the offense.
Yeah, I got holding on offense.
There is no 68.
Fred Nordgren is 68. Is Fred out there?
No, ought not to be. The guards are Chuck Pitcock and Matt Newton.
The players are out there going, what was the number? We know Fred's on the sideline. He's sitting there.
Hook you right at that.
How long has Fred been playing the phantom offensive guard?
Third down and about 11.
And it could have been first and 10.
Raider! 390! 390!
And I think maybe Matt Newton might have moved on that play. He had used locked horns over there.
Yep. Number 61 offense, third down. Now, they have Matt Newton listed as 290 pounds, but talking to the coaches before the game yesterday, he came into camp at 310 pounds, Keith.
Yeah, the thing that's frightening about it, though, is they said he runs about a 4.6 at 290. That's terrifying. And that guy's born at that.
Well, get him downfield.
Run it,
that's
run
right.
It.
Get behind him. A barricade that moves.
390.
Third and 16. Reaves passes away and intercepted by Luther Bradley. He tried to force it, and he paid for it. So Bradley, who, what was it last year? He had six interceptions?
Last year, he had six interceptions against the Bandits while playing for the Arizona Wranglers, which are now, of course, the Arizona Outlaws. Out of Notre Dame, he is able to pick this pass off. Not so much that the receiver was covered, but look at how soft this pass comes through the air. It's not a bullet, it just floats. This gives Bradley time to adjust to it, come back. The receiver falls down, he can't come back to the ball hard enough, and it's an easy pickoff. Now,
I'm told that Chuck Clinton has picked off three passes today over at Birmingham for the Spaniards. Ball is on the 20, where it's first down, Houston. Tampa's 20. Kelly's pass down the middle is caught by Verdin. Touchdown, just like that. Boy, they are quick. Rich comes on now to Matt
seconds. In case you're wondering, I'm very preoccupied with the time of these scoring drives because they happen so quickly. You talk about a team's comeback potential to play from behind. The Houston Gamblers showed they had it last week. And in case you thought it might have been just one of those lucky situations, one quarter of great play, here you're seeing the perfect example of what they can do consistently in a ballgame. Scoring 5 seconds, scoring 11 seconds, scoring 7 minutes to possess the clock if they choose to.
So it is now with 6:38 to play in the third quarter, 45-21. Jim Kelly may set out the next series. Todd Dillon's warming up, his backup at quarterback. Houston has had 6 possessions. It's been punt, touchdown, touchdown, field goal, touchdown, touchdown. 6 possessions, 45 points. Here's the kickoff. Futrell, 3-yard line. He pops it and gets out to about the 30 before he is brought down by Dennis Devon at 6:27 to go in the third quarter. Jimmy Jordan is in at quarterback now for the Tampa Bay Bandits, 200-pounder out of Florida State. Jimmy last week in relief of Reaves, 3 out of 6, 52 yards, was picked off one time. Jimmy stands in there at 6'1". He's been seasoned for 2 years. He struggled last year with a bad shoulder. He can be very effective. Joel Blunt out of the backfield and brought down by Andy Hawkins. Gain of about 5. And the Super Bikers will be running on 3 different surfaces. ABC's Wide World of Sports next Saturday at 4:30 Eastern Time. Jordan drops again on 2nd down and 5 and misses the tight end, Marvin Harvey.
Time Jordan trying to throw while backing up was John Reaves and his statistics on the day.
Those are pretty fair set of stats right there.
Not bad, but
those 2 interceptions, though, both times Houston cashed them in.
They certainly did.
There's Todd Dillon, who may be coming into the ball game in the next possession for the Gamblers out of Long Beach State. He's a record setter out there. Jordan on 3rd down and 5. Rolls it out, throws, gets his tight end, Harvey, and gets a 1st down out of it. Just across the 44-yard line.
See, what Jimmy Jordan might bring to the Tampa Bay Bandits offense, what may be needed at this point, is a change of pace. The defense has been accustomed now to seeing Reaves in there. They've got a game plan prepared for what Reaves does when he's behind the center. Now there's a new man, a new thinking in there. He's going to do things just slightly different. His timing is going to be different, so he can shake things up a bit.
So on the 1st down play, just over the 44. Staying in the air. Going deep. Carter can't hold on as he collides with the defender, Will Lewis. A crowd today here in Tampa, 42,291.
Jimmy Jordan must have gotten some information from Carter that he could catch this pass, get open, because he is covered, but he gives Carter a chance to go for it anyway. He throws it inside and high. Carter has a chance to make the catch. Can't hang on to it as Lewis just deflects it a little bit after he touched the football.
Second and 10.
Tremendous credit to the Houston defensive line. They have been supplying pressure all day long, getting into the backfield. Jimmy Jordan threw that one, seemed like he was falling back on his back. He couldn't get his arm or his body into that pass. It floated up in the air short, picked off.
Up
to the line comes Houston now, and it's Jim Kelly at quarterback. Flag finally, and after all of that milling around, it's almost surely holding.
Offensive line certainly gave him
an ineligible man downfield. You know, poor old offensive lineman now, I tell you, they don't get a whole lot of credit, but dadgummit, he's out there scrummaging around. How does the offensive lineman know what's going on?
He's got to give him a go call to let him know. Well, I'll tell you one thing, there's a guy that's on the field, or was on the field, number 65, Dan Rosado. He's off on the sideline right now. And here's a very interesting story, Keith. He hadn't played football for 5 years. After finishing up at Northern Illinois, he wasn't selected in the draft, took a job in the beverage business. And
here you go,
put on some weight,
zero.
Wanted
ready
to get down to good shape. Started working out and realized he was just as strong as he was when he was in college. Tried out for the Houston team and made it.
Good at 6 left!
On second down and 20, Kelly goes deep downfield for Verdin, Courville, and Courville can't run it down. Pass led him just a little too much, but Vince had broken loose from the coverage. Another score out of Birmingham, third quarter, Denver now 33-21 over the Stallions. Vince Evans having a big day.
Come on now.
Thrown for two touchdowns and run for one.
He's finally learning what this running shoot offense is all about. Interesting fact is that number 22, Richard Johnson, was a receiver for the Denver Gold.
Sam Zero, ready?
Wasn't playing there, was traded.
Listen up.
To the Houston Gamblers. I bet you right now, Darrell Davis wish he had him back in Denver.
Through the traffic, got him right around the ankles and brought him down back across midfield. He got a hold call against Houston. Well, Tampa Bay may very well have choose to decline the holding call and bring up fourth down and about 25. That's what they do. 4:37 to go in the third quarter. While they're changing the teams on the field, let us pause 5 seconds to allow our local stations to identify themselves. Walters is in the punt. Bruce Vaughn is deep for Tampa Bay. Walters only kicked today, 41 yards. Difference anyway, so they'll take the 5 yards, and it'll give Walters a little more field to work with if he wants to try to hang it up there and get coverage on it. I don't imagine Bruce Vaughn wants to make a fair catch back inside the 10-yard line either.
Yeah.
It's a 45-21 ball game right now. Tampa Bay looking very impressive in the opening possession of the half, but they closed it to 31-21, and then bang, bang, the Gamblers put two more in there. Got some pressure, but he gets it away, and it's a very good kick to the carry into the end zone. It's a very good kick from the standpoint of distance, but not terribly efficient because Tampa Bay will come out to the 20. It was a 55-yard punt, and you've got timeout. Denver holding on to that lead we gave you a moment ago against Birmingham, despite the fact that Birmingham's intercepted Vince Evans three times, but Evans has thrown for two and run for one. Arizona 14-7 now over San Antonio, and the Baltimore Stars are out to a 7-0 lead over the Oakland Invaders in the second quarter, and Chuck Cusina, whose hand was injured last week, did start today at quarterback for the Stars, the defending champion. Tampa Bay now first down at the 20 with Jimmy Jordan in there at quarterback. Is complete up around the 24, short pickup to Jerry Price at tight end. Price out of Mississippi, who was with Arizona before coming here to Tampa Bay. He would have had the first down. But it's easier said up here than done down there.
You see Steve Spurrier very upset with that kind of play, but all competitors think that they can make the big play.
Third and two now instead of being a first down. And they don't get the first down. So now they're looking at fourth and two. Way back on their side of the field, and I think they have to punt the ball.
Similar situation they were in before. When the receiver Spencer didn't pick up the first down. And then there was a penalty, and they had to march back, and they never did move the ball.
Well, there's an old basic law. Know where the marker is.
Receiver should know where the marker is. Should go forward for it. Situation like this, instead of always thinking the big play, you got to make the smart play.
All right, here we go. They're going to try it. They're down. 24 points, so they're going on fourth and two from their own 28.
That is good.
So Tampa will turn over the ball to Houston at their own 28-yard line.
Well, the last time Houston had the football, next to last time they had the football, they had the ball in similar field position. It took them 11 seconds to find the receiver open in one play and score a touchdown.
Well, Mr. Kelly comes out, and he's looking for a half a hundred plus now. If he gets in the end zone, it'll be, they've already scored more points, obviously, than the previous game they played. They won against Los Angeles 34-33 with three touchdowns in the fourth quarter last week.
Let's see, they have 45 points. Three of them were scored in the field goal, the other six on touchdowns. Two on special teams return, so that means Kelly's thrown for how many? Four?
Slides down at the 22. He sort of ducked, and James Ramey overran him, and he got away.
You watch him here. You know he's surprised. Watch the pressure.
Oops.
He thought he was going down.
Here you go, Sam Zero, ready?
And he takes off.
Louis!
Pardee. Selected last year as the coach of the year in the USFL.
Second down and about three as they run a draw play with Gerald Clark. And Clark has the first down. Second year man out of Texas, 195-pounder, pounds his way down to the 15-yard line.
Now you're going to see what the Houston Gamblers' idea of possession football is and eating up the clock is. That's going to mean a couple of runs in every 10 or so passes. Kirchbaum, our linebacker whose Mike has not been that effective so far in the ballgame. Making all the calls for the defense.
On the phone there.
He's got a man. He had McGee in the end zone. He had Scott McGee in the end zone, but McGee broke open as Kelly was looking to the left side, threw instead to Verdin, and the pass was dropped. McGee had broken on a curl back along the back of the end zone, and he had come free.
Nickel.
By running down in the third quarter. Tampa now sending in a nickel defense.
Don't think I'll leave a tough
one.
Maybe
even six.
Up to the Bandits office on Monday.
It's tough for that defensive group, especially linebackers, when you find yourself covering swift receivers all day, crossing in and out of your territory.
Five defensive backs. to Verdin. He gets some help. Short of the first down, though, as he's run out of bounds near the 7. So it'll be third down. They'll lead about 2. See, this is one of the things I think that made the Miami Dolphins so effective, too, was what those receivers did with the ball after they caught it.
Well, they're running smart with the football, Keith. They know where the open portions of the field are because of their pass patterns and what the defense is doing. But another factor that we haven't mentioned out here is that the receivers are doing an excellent job of blocking for one another downfield. McNeil, Verdin, Sanders when he was in there, Johnson, all doing an exceptional job.
Ball is fumbled. There's a man in a white shirt on top of it at the 5-yard line. So it's a turnover, and Tampa Bay will turn the Houston Gamblers away this time. Warren Hanna covered the loose ball. There's the man, number 20, Hanna. Clark now on the handoff here from Kelly. Never had it. Never had it. And Hanna saw it bouncing loose, and Warren went after it and got it. The first turnover by Houston.
I don't know how much of a break that is at this point in the ballgame, but any break is welcome from Tampa Bay standpoint.
Well, they got him pinned back on the 5. Yards away from the end zone, the Bandits, and Jimmy Jordan stays in at quarterback.
Everyone lined up in man-to-man coverage. Probably thought they might come with a blitz, but they were just playing it safe. The linebacker stayed back. Gave it to Boone quickly on the inside. Still a good game.
Third quarter's about over. It is. So we've played 45 minutes, and the Houston Gamblers have 45 points to Tampa's 21. Back after this message and a word from our local stations.
Time with them. The stats look like everything should be going well for the Tampa Bay Bandits, but it isn't. We've got special teams just dominated this game in the first half. The Houston defense has played exceptionally well and stopping Tampa also. You don't see that reflected in statistics.
Third and 5 from the 10. Keep running.
More importantly, so does Eric Trevelyan. You'll see this play. He comes out to the outside. Jordan does a good job in giving him a chance to make this catch. He's covered well, but he'll go up in the air and make a very good catch. You see right there. Now, when he comes down, he's going towards the sideline. He's struggling, thinks he can break free, trying to protect the football.
Adrian Simpson brought him down. Keeps on running, though. That's the key thing. Handoff goes to Gary Anderson over the left side. He's got about 5. Moves the football from the 38 up near the 43. 13:50 to play in the football game. And the Bandits are down by 24.
Pick up at about 5 yards.
Jim Eddy, the defensive coordinator for the Houston Gamblers, he's done a fantastic job. Spent 10 years up in Canada before joining the Houston Gamblers in 83.
They go to Greg Boone this time, and Boone on the draw up the middle.
Gets, I got him out here.
About half of the 5 they needed. They'll be looking at 3rd and about 2, and here's another score where San Antonio has gone ahead of Arizona 16-14 in the 4th quarter. Sack Doug Williams. You see Boone coming out, shaking up.
Buddy,
went ahead on a sack of Doug Williams, who's playing on a pair of sore knees, to take that 16-14 lead. Third and two. They go to Bluck, and Bluck's got the first down for the Bandits, down around the Houston 45.
On the ground, Keith, Gary Anderson is carried for the Bandits 13 times for 39 yards, and Boone is carried 9 times for a total of 42. So the Gamblers came in here wanting to stop the ground attack, making things confusing in the passing game. They've done that.
Well, next week, the Los Angeles Express out to an 0-2 start, losing to Houston 34-33, and last night to Portland 14-10. Next Sunday on ABC. New Jersey. The pass is overthrown, intended for Larry Brodsky at double coverage. Of course, there's going to be a lot of interest in that. You know that Los Angeles has got to be a little upset over the 0-2 start. There's a fellow named McAdoo that played an awfully good ball game last night at linebacker for Dick Corey's ball club up in Portland. And New Jersey getting their first win of the season at Orlando on Friday night. And here's the final score. San Antonio beat Arizona 16-14. Would not want to have supper with Frank Cook. Back goes Jordan on second and 10. Throws, pass caught. Short of the first down by Gary Anderson out of the backfield. He was shirt-tailed by Andy Hawkins, number 59.
Andy Hawkins is one man who should be happy that he doesn't have a tearaway jersey, because that's all he got.
He
was that shirt-tail. Anderson caught that pass and turned it up and had his jets going. Andy just did grab him by the collar and haul him down.
Third down and three now for Tampa Bay. Kiki Diallo, who's had some neck troubles and back spasms, is back into the lineup now at middle linebacker for Houston. Anderson pitches it back to Jordan. Jordan's got Trevelyan wide open down the middle and goes to the wrong man, and it's intercepted. He tried to throw the ball deep downfield, and Derwood Rockamore comes up with the interception, and he's still working at it. Finally, they put him down up around the 26. He had Trevelyan about 20 yards deep, wide open.
He sure did, coming in underneath. Trying to go deep. Spurrier, well,
just picked
out
the wrong man.
A little frustrated. Yep.
And so the Bandits turn it over again. Todd Dillon replaces Jim Kelly at quarterback, with Houston leading 45-21. And the reason for Dillon being in is obvious. One, the team is sitting on a 24-point cushion. Two, he needs the work, because something might happen along the way, and he would be the man. Played at Cal State Long Beach.
Go! 26-12!
Goes right to the air. Throws, and the ball goes sailing through the hands of the receiver, Scott McGee. Dillon has a gun for an arm. At Cal State Long Beach, he rolled up all kinds of school records. And 1982, he set 16 school and PCAA records. The number two man in NCAA history for total offense in a single season, as he went for 3,587. He can whistle.
Read him, read him. Louis, Louis!
Go!
Corner trip left!
Tries to shoot one down the middle to Mark Barus, number 82. And it was just too much traffic there for Barus. 5'9", 180 speedster out of McNeese State. Here's Todd Fowler, who figures to be back in a couple of 3 weeks from a knee injury. It'll be remarkable if he comes back that quick, because he had ligament damage.
They only need 10 now.
That's the voice of Kelly Kirchbaum, inside linebacker for Tampa.
8-16, right?
Yeah.
Read your guards hard. Louis, Louis!
Go!
Good set!
Third and 10 for Dillon. Goes short. Sort of a screen set up for Darrell Clark. And Clark close to a first down, but looks like he's about a yard short. Darrell was just a little bit ahead of his screen on the play.
Yes, he was. You heard Kelly saying, read the guards hard. Been what he was looking for them sitting up in the screen, or to see if they were going to roll out or just drop back and pass the ball.
fourth and one, and Houston will punt it away as Walters and the kicking team comes on. Obviously leading 45-21. The ball at your own 34, you're going to punt it. Walters, 41 and 55 on his two kicks today. Bruce Vaughn is the deep man for the Bandits. Pretty good kick. Oh, my. Vaughn is cut down back on the 25, coming downfield, Clarence Verdin. So this little guy will do it all. Works special teams, comes down and cuts the legs out from Vaughn after a 40-yard punt. 1,291 at Tampa Stadium today. And here's a fourth quarter score with 7 minutes to play. Denver is now out to a 40-21 lead over the Birmingham Stallions. Birmingham was a heavy favorite. Jordan, the air to the sidelines. Trevilian, first down. Pass complete up at the 37.
Pass complete for the right four.
Jim Kelly apparently through for the day, unless Tampa Bay comes storming back. He's right now with our man, Tim Brandt.
All right, Keith, he is through for the day. 79 points in 2 weeks, and you had some opportunities here that you missed. It's awesome.
Well, thank you. It's just a matter of us going out there and executing. And like I said a long time ago, if I get the time to throw, we can do it. And our special teams have been doing an excellent job, and our defense is out there right now. It's about the same time we were last week when we came back, and we just hopefully our defense can hold them today.
How would you defend against it? How would you defend against your own offense?
I don't know. It's tough. I don't know. The only thing I can say is if we screw up ourselves and make mistakes like fumbles like happened there and just mental mistakes on our own part.
All right, Jimmy. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Keith.
Big, strong Irishman. Comes out of that same general area where so many great quarterbacks have come from, including his contemporary in the NFL.
Western Pennsylvania. Western Pennsylvania.
Jordan's pass is away, complete to Greg Boone, and Boone moves it from the 37 up to about the 40, 41 maybe. Call it a 4-yard pickup. It'll bring up second down, a third down, and six now. 9:27 to play in the game, the clock running.
You know, with people like Dan Marino, Joe Namath, Montana, Jim Kelly, Johnny Unitas, all coming out of the Western Pennsylvania area, people keep saying, why don't the Pennsylvania teams draft them? They did, Unitas, but they cut them.
Jordan back on third and six. And so the ball comes out of there on the hard hit. Jerry Price had it, but he took a lick. Luther Bradley was involved.
Right now you have a whole completely different ball game than what we've seen for the other three quarters, Keith. Obviously, the Bandits have to play catch-up. They're going to put the ball in the air. The Houston defensive line continues to charge and put pressure on people. Well, their secondary just sits back and waits.
And position to punt it. Calvin Eason is deep for Houston now, making an appearance in the ball game. Drops it, picks it up, and goes down at the 27. 38-yard punt and a 4-yard return with 8 minutes and 52 seconds to play in the game.
Really?
Just flipping through the record book here. This may be the worst licking that Tampa Bay has had. Michigan beat them 30-7 April of last year. They haven't been whipped many times like this.
No, they haven't.
Bam. Zero. Watch the screen now. Tell us something. Louis!
Go!
Louis Rogers! Check Rogers!
Dylan, a little quick pop to the sideline. The pass is good to Baruch, and Mark Baruch steps out of bounds after picking up about 5 yards.
I don't think Baruch wanted to step out of bounds.
Nope. He had some room.
You heard Kurt Baum there calling out Louis. And then checking off, Louis is the...
Here we go, Sam Zero, ready?
The left side linebacker, and he just checked off. And what he checked
Louis.
I'm not sure. But when you saw the man go in motion, he wanted to come out of his set defense and check into something else for that particular formation.
Going trips!
Right now they're going to trips. The defense against three wide receivers on one side.
And the pass is thrown too high to Verdin. Clarence Verdin was over there. And he had a couple of guys to help him work his way downfield, but Dillon threw the ball hard and high. With a guy like Kelly around, though, Todd Dillon just didn't figure to
Same thing, man. Get up.
No, he won't. Not unless he just gets hurt. Oh, they have a lot of blowouts.
This time he hit Scott McGee. And it looked like the ball came loose, but it's going to be ruled a catch, apparently.
And a fumble.
And a fumble in Tampa Bay's ball. So McGee had it and then took a lick. And the ball came out, and the Bandits get it with 8:17 to play in the game.
See, when Tim Brandt talked to Kelly on the sideline, he asked him, what would it be like to have to defense the run-and-shoot offense? Well, he's going to find out, because the fourth game of the season, they play the Denver Gold, which right now is beating Birmingham Stallions, and he'll see that run-and-shoot offense.
From the 42, Tampa Bay's ball. Jordan has some time, now throws short to Boone, and Boone can't hang on because black shirts arrived about the time the ball did, in particular, Mike Hawkins. And Willie Harper, who was just signed, is in the ball game, the veteran out of Nebraska. Let me ask Tim Brandt a question. Now, we've been talking about things, and Timmy played defense at Maryland, was a good football player. How do you feel about it after you've been down on that field watching that covey of quail come out, Timmy?
I'll tell you what, I think Steve Spurrier had a good game plan. They just didn't execute. They used six defensive backs. They came up. They were bumping the guys off the line. They were using some combination defenses, which is simply zone one side, man to the other side. They were trying to give Jim Kelly some different looks, but the problem was Kelly had so much time, he could sit and pick and choose, and by that time, if you give a quarterback a lot of time, as Swanee knows, then they'll eventually work their way open, and that's what happened today.
Do you consider that the linebackers, Timmy, having to go against such small, fast receivers?
We got the red flag. Excuse me, Swanee. We got the red flag now as Jack Pardee is called a challenge here, and Tom White will come across and talk to Cal Lepore, the supervisor of officials. So while they're doing that, I don't really know what the challenge is about, but you go ahead.
Well, just interested, Timmy, if you think that the matchup was just so lopsided with the receivers going against the Tampa Bay Bandits linebackers most of the day.
Well, Tampa Bay only used one linebacker most of the day, Lynn. They used Kirchbaum in there, and the rest of it was all defensive backs. So I don't think that was the problem. I think it was just time, and it was execution. It was funny. I was talking to Clarence Verdin and McNeil and a couple of these guys, and they said, hey, you know, Lynn Swann couldn't play on our offense. He's not fast enough, and he's not small enough.
Take that, all pro.
I hope you burn up from that jacket on the sideline. What do you mean I'm not fast enough? Granted, I know I'm a big guy compared to these people.
Hey, they're telling me down here they can run 4.2 40s. I don't know if that's true.
That's the beauty of it for me, Timmy. While they're running 4.2 down the sideline, clearing out zones for me, I can take my time, drift in the seam, catch a pass or 10 or 15 yards and be on my way.
I'm just teasing. You know, this is a dream. I think you mentioned that earlier, that anybody working against a defensive back, if he's one-on-one, knows where he's going and has a couple of options. These receivers have two and three options every time they go out. And ironically, Jim Kelly has to read the receiver. It's all post-snap read, so he drops back. That receiver will look at the defensive back, make his break on which way he thinks he can get open, and then Jim has to read him and hit him. It's virtually impossible to stop.
The challenge by Pardee was disallowed, and back goes Jordan to throw on second down and 10. Goes down the middle with it, and the pass is incomplete off the hands of Larry Brodsky. It was a little bit too high, so Jimmy Jordan, all pumped up, has been high on some of his passes, and a penalty flag is thrown in the backfield.
Okay, here's the play that the challenge was called on. He felt that this should have been called a fumble.
No.
But with his back, Boone's back was to Pardee, and he couldn't see that Boone never had possession of the football. He was bobbling it, therefore, no upholding.
Well, he lost the appeal, and as a result, his team is charged with a timeout, which means Houston has two left. We had the challenge of a fumble early in the second half, and it was inconclusive, and the simple statement by the USFL is, if it's not a black-and-white situation, it goes as called, and that's exactly the way they handle it. Back goes Jordan, rolling. Wants to go deep, throws it, Carter's down there.
A
over number 21, Adrian Simpson. So while the secondary was somewhat lax, sitting back comfortably on a 45-27 lead, Stephen Carter and Jimmy Jordan team up.
Carter's only rookie on this squad, with getting playing time, too.
Well, see Jimmy Jordan putting everything he had in that pass, getting it high and deep. Excellent pass is dropped in right over the shoulder of Simpson into the hands of Stephen Carter.
Jordan is now 9 out of 20 for 124 yards, been picked off twice in relief of John Reaves, but now he's put a touchdown up there, and it's a 45-27 ball game, 45-28 ball game, and the kick is good. So they have, with this touchdown, moved themselves out of the worst licking. It was Chicago Blitz back in the first year, 83, that beat them 42-3 at Chicago. Right now, with 7:21 to play in this football game, it is 45-28, Houston with a 17-point lead. Up Jimmy Jordan's morale a tad, I would say, and he might very well win that starting job back because he had the starting job at one time, if you remember, back in that first year when Reaves was having some shoulder problems and was having some bad games, and Jimmy stepped in there and did a good job, then he got hurt. 7:21 is a lot of time. With a couple of breaks, it could get closer.
Especially since this Houston team is going to throw the football. A couple of big defensive plays right away, and they could be back in it.
Look out for this. There's your onside kick, and it is covered by Houston at the 44. Mike Mitchell diving ahead and covering the ball at the 44. Well, I know that they've got two or three trick plays, too, Tampa does, that we've not seen yet.
Two or three? Maybe like 20 or 30.
23, yeah. Wouldn't be surprised to see something like the swinging gate. They've got one play where they split their tackles out and set up with a three-man front. All kinds of things available if they ever got in a position to use them. But right now, they've got to be concerned with their defense because the Gamblers are setting on the Tampa Bay 45 with the start of this possession. Bob Dylan back to throw it. Gave it off inside. Well, that was good ball handling because I didn't see the handoff. He popped it into Darrell Clark's stomach so quickly, and Clark, on a quick popper ahead, picked up the better part of 5 yards on the carry. Tampa Bay now with 3 timeouts remaining. Houston with 2, and as the clock winds on down, the Bandits are going to have to start spending some. Bruce Threadgill of Mississippi State is in the lineup, but he's in there as a slot back, and he came out of college as a quarterback. Listed as a quarterback earlier this year, and he just dropped the ball.
Catches like a defensive back. I shouldn't say that. He just got into the ball game. He's a little rusty. You see, Baltimore over the Invaders, 17-0 in the third quarter. Chuck Piscina, his stats. He's having a pretty good day for a man with a sore hand.
Well, the imposing thing to me is the zero there by Oakland, because that's Bobby Hebert, Bassana. Good football team. Eric Jordan is back with them now. But obviously, the Philadelphia, Baltimore, the Stars have been able to get some of their defensive people back.
Well, they've got a good solid line with Pete Kugler in there. And if they're getting some help from their linebackers, secondary people, they should be pretty solid.
Dylan is sacked. Through Fred Nordgren, number 68, and he decks Dylan back at the 45.
Fred Nordgren, the offensive guard, defensive tackle.
Fourth sack of Houston quarterback today by Tampa Bay. Here's Tim for a moment.
Hey, Keith, we're talking about all the good things Houston has had today, but on the downside, injuries has been a very, very bad thing that's happened to the Gamblers, and one is here with me, Sam Harrell. How badly did you hurt the ankle?
It's not hurt really bad, but it's hurt bad enough to keep me out of the game. It's a nagging injury on my ankle. It's been twisted pretty well, but I'll be ready next week.
All right, Ricky Sanders is out. Richard Johnson was hurt coming in, so they've had some injuries, Keith.
Dale Walters shoots a sky high. Howitzer into the air, and the Gamblers are going to kill it way down there, just short of the goal line. Maybe a yard out, Anthony Brock down to cover that high, towering punt. And they got a good bounce on it that they could handle. So it goes as a 45-yard punt. There is no return, and Tampa Bay is marked inside the one. The paved road, the dirt oval, and motocross course.
Safety!
They got him in the end zone. It was Lloyd Lewis, number 68 out of Texas A&I, who has the lineman's dream. He got the quarterback and decked him in the end zone, and it's now 47-28. Well, there's not much you can do if you're on the Tampa Bay side right now, except I think grit your teeth and get prepared to go to work tomorrow.
That's it.
Boom.
He's lucky he didn't drop that football. Allow one of those big linemen to jump on it for a touchdown. Jimmy Jordan didn't see him coming. Hit from the blind side.
They'll kick it away now, and Houston will get it back. Now the Bandits will have to start spending their timeouts, trying to save as much time as possible. But it's 47-28, 19-point lead right now. Gerald McNeil will be the return man for the Houston Gamblers.
Dave, I'm not saying by any stretch of the imagination Steve Spurrier has given up, but I think if you look at his face and the way he's standing on the sideline, he's pretty much conceded this ballgame. It's pretty difficult for them to come back and overtake them at this point.
There's going to be a lot of folks around the league 1-1 after this weekend. Birmingham losing. They were losing substantially. Oakland, Baltimore, all in there at 1-1. So some of the better teams, at least on paper, that we've seen so far. Position punts it, and McNeil has it at the 26.
Oh no!
Look out! He goes out of bounds, and he is hit out of bounds. So tack on a personal foul to his return. Gerald McNeil, exciting, had a 79-yard punt return for a touchdown earlier in the ball game. He was hit by Dwayne Anderson, it looked like, out of bounds. And Dwayne, of course, wasn't concerned with the line marker. He was concerned with McNeil. It burned him already.
That's right. I was about to say before they punted.
Personal foul. Late
this
hit
is no safe situation.
Number 26, Tampa Bay.
No safe situation for the Bandits having to punt the football. With all the trouble they've gotten into this year on special teams, this game and special teams scoring points.
The personal foul to it, and the ball goes inside the Bandits 20. First down Houston at the Tampa Bay 19. 5:06 to play in the game. Dylan end zone. Redgill had it on his hands. He was short of the end zone. But Dylan threw it perfectly. It was right on Bruce Threadgill's hands, and he couldn't hold it in front of Bruce Vaughn.
Al Richardson, the left inside linebacker, had jumped up in the air to give him a little bit of a distraction. See right there, so he puts his hands on it, and he bobbled just a second, and Bruce Vaughn comes in and makes sure he doesn't catch it by pulling his arms in and down to his side.
Threadgill has had the taste of things as a receiver now. He leaves the ball game.
Because he didn't like it?
Maybe. Dylan's got four of them down the middle. McNeil, and Gerald won't hang on to that one. I think he might have been concerned just a little bit over the safety of his body there, because there were three Bandits that had him in the sights. Well, you know, we're talking about teams being 1-1, Johnny. There could be 9 teams at 1-1.
Right. Here again, you see it on a replay. When the score is 47-28, and you've already taken your share of punishment, you come across, start thinking a little bit in the ballgame when you're a little more relaxed about making sure you go out of it in one piece.
Dylan back again for McGee, and overthrows on the play. He had double coverage. And so that will bring up a fourth down. No, that was fourth down. And that'll bring on... it brings up fourth down. I'm losing count. Feel like I've been here a week. 3 minutes to go. It's Denver 40 and Birmingham 23 now.
There's a young lady who had the benefit of watching a football and on the beach at the same time. She came dressed to get a little suntan.
I tell you, when you have the Gamblers, bring a picnic lunch, right? 36-yard field goal for Tony Fritsch. Got it. So he's kicked 38 and 36. And Tampa Bay now goes to a half a hundred. Look at this.
Kelly's rubbing the top of his head for good luck or what? I was on the sideline Saturday, and some of the players said, Tony's out here somewhere. I said, where is he? I haven't seen him. He says, once you see him, you'll never forget that body. You can't miss it.
Well, he's kicked two field goals, plus all the conversions. He's climbing right into the old scoring column today, isn't he?
Yeah, yes, he is. When you play on a team that scores as much as Houston, for a kicker, it's ideal, because you're going to get the opportunity to kick a lot of extra points. And if the team doesn't score, you at least feel you're going to get close enough to get a shot at the field goal.
Hey, Timmy, go over there and ask Tony.
Tony.
There you go. All right. What do you want to know? First, how's this help? How's your help?
Oh, I tell you, I feel good, you know. Today, you know, this game for a kicker is the best practice, you know. I could kick him all afternoon.
You're no young chicken anymore.
I mean, you know, I'm still 39 and holding, you know. I said this already 4 or 5 years ago, but still I hit him pretty good and I feel fine, you know.
All right, Keith. Ask him if he intends to pass up the warm-up programs. I know he pulled a muscle in the jumping jacks exercise last week.
Keith wants to know if you're going to start passing up the exercises since you pulled a muscle last week.
Yeah, you know, he saw me yesterday how I worked out, you know. I mean, I'm warm up for 21 years, you know, 18 soccer and 14 years in football, so I think I'd be stretched enough now.
You've got to be loose after 20 years.
He's delightful. That was a good return by Carter. Jordan hooks up with Brodsky, and the Bandits now have it on Houston's side of the field, and here you've got a penalty flag thrown after the catch. So you might tack on a foul here, and we'll move Tampa Bay on down the field with 4:17 to play in the ball game.
Face mask, number 39, defense.
Get a ball.
He gets the ball. He always gets the ball.
We'll find out by how far he marks it, if it's an inadvertent face mask or intentional.
It's 5 yards. And it's on the Houston 41. Overthrown. Could have been picked off. Almost was by Tommy Myers, who had 11 years at New Orleans.
That pass was intended for Larry Brodsky, and from up here in the press box, I couldn't tell from the perspective if that ball was too high for him to jump for, or if he thought it was being thrown to someone else.
I think we're just overthrown. We could have 10 teams at 1-1 after this weekend. Could have. That will have. Jordan shoots it. This time it is caught by Carter. And so Steve Carter now, the youngster out of Albany State, beginning to run up numbers. That will total a big ball game for him. And it's another first down for Tampa Bay at the 24 of Houston.
Steve Carter's playing very well today.
50 to 28. Gamblers have the game in hand. Jordan goes to the corner for Carter, and it's overthrown. Here's a big little man, Gerald McNeil with Tim.
All right, Keith, we've talked about this offense and the wide receivers, but really what broke the game open early was the return play, and you had those long runs.
Yeah, we worked real hard on our special teams. Myself and Clarence, for them, we made it a number one goal this year. We're going to lead the league in returns. We're going to set the stage for offense. You know, everybody talk about how we produce and produce on offense. We got a little fast guys, so, you know, we really want to work real hard on special teams.
All right, thank you. Mm-hmm. Goes Jordan again on 2nd and 10. Goes the short way, hits Jerry Price, the tight end. And Price looks like he's a little short of his first down.
Well, those low receivers not only have made the plays as receivers and kick return specialists, but they're also making the plays today, Keith, as coverage people. Getting down the field very quickly, allowing very little return yardage on many of the punting situations.
On 3rd and 3, it is picked off. Intercepted by number 21, Adrian Simpson, and he fumbles it back, and Tampa recovers it. Adrian was trying to change hands with the ball. Had it knocked loose, Joel Blunk comes over to recover it, and the Bandits will keep it.
That's called picking up the first down the hard way. That's it right here. He just times it just right. Watching the quarterback. The ball is thrown behind Trevilian, way behind Trevilian. He takes off, and he's just going to lose the ball, trying to pick up the extra yards. Gets up in the air. Ball's coming off his shoulder. And there it is.
So it's first down from the 30. This one's picked off by Tommy Myers. And Myers waiting for some help. And the veteran comes back to about the 39. So Jimmy Jordan has suffered the indignity of successive interceptions on successive plays. Look at Steve Spurrier banging his head on the ground. That is the sixth interception in the game by Houston.
That's okay, Steve. Unfortunately, we all have those kind of days.
And they never are fun.
They never are. You're trying to get them. You learn from them by watching the film, the mistakes.
My kids, honey.
And you come back and improve upon it.
Houston will go to work at the 39 with 2:34 to play in the ball game. They've got a half a 50-28. And off is inside to Clark. And a short game for Darryl Clark. I was looking through the book. I'm quite sure that Gerald McNeil was a communications major at Baylor. I was just going to tell Tim, don't give him too much airtime.
He gets lots of airtime. How many passes have they thrown?
He ran on three state championship track teams out of Killeen, Texas. So that'll give you some idea how fast he is.
9.2 speed.
Yes, sir. 2 minute warning in the ball game. 50-28. Houston has the lead. We figured this was going to be a long ball game.
With all the passes
it has
thrown.
98 attempts. That is a record for the league.
Most of the attempts today coming from the Tampa Bay Bandits, as they've had possession of the football for most of this ball game. Houston coming up with some very big scores, two touchdowns on a punt return and a kickoff return.
The issue is no longer in doubt at 2 minutes to play.
No, it isn't.
And Houston with the ball. Second down and seven. Dillon's caught behind the line of scrimmage by James Harrell. Harrell, who plays that outside linebacker almost like a cornerback, because he's well involved in pass coverage and also very active along the line of scrimmage. So he comes up with a sack, and Dillon is back on the 31. So that means they've got to go to the 49 to get the first down. They need 18 yards on third down. The Hawkins brothers, Mike and Andy. They're pretty tough. A couple of customers in that linebacking spot. Here's your final score. Denver beat Birmingham 40-23. Dillon ducks away from one pursuer, now runs for it, and he is brought down. Well short of the first down, so they'll have to kick the ball away. Evans with a big day, 14 out of 28. But look at the yardage, 284 yards. He was picked off three times. That surprises me. It really does.
It's very surprising.
Birmingham looked so solid last week, though they did ease up a little bit, I think, after they got their big lead. And then once Flutie got things in motion in the fourth quarter, it got a little anxious for them. But today, Denver was in it all the way against them and led from the outset.
I'm not sure exactly what happened on last play, but Gerald McNeil was on all fours for a while, pulled himself up off the ground, and just barely made it over to the sideline.
There's your punt by Walters, and he's had a good day with the punt. He came in with less than a 32-yard average, but he's banged the ball well today. The return is by Bruce Vaughn for Tampa, and Bruce is down at about the 26-yard line. And the clock rolling along now. You have 30 seconds showing on the game clock. 33-13 deficit to beat the Los Angeles Express last Sunday. They have come into Tampa and beat a very good football team today roundly by a score of 50-28. 30 seconds to play. Jordan is the quarterback. Jimmy back to throw. Goes to the sidelines, and it's promptly dropped by Larry Brodsky because the obvious reason, Larry was looking for a place to run and trying as well to not only get the first down but get out of bounds to save time. That took 4 seconds.
Trying to do too many things at the same time.
Next Sunday, it'll be Doug Flutie and Steve Young as the Los Angeles Express go into New Jersey to play the Generals. To Carter. Carter is down at the 31, short of the first down, and that is the 100th pass attempt in the ball game by the two teams. John Reaves started, had a pretty good day, but just trying to find some lightning. Steve Spurrier put Jimmy Jordan in there. Jimmy's done a good job as well, as Carter catches and twists ahead for the first down at 4 seconds to play in the ball game. We hope you've enjoyed watching the run-and-shoot offense of Jack Pardee and the Houston Gamblers. We'll see him again down the road. Last snap of the game. Good to Price. Price is dragged down at the 47. The ball game is over. Your final score, Houston 50, Tampa Bay 28. Stay tuned next on the West Coast for ABC Sports Beat with Howard Cosell. Coming up for the other areas of the country, ABC World News Sunday with Sam Donaldson. Travel arrangements made through, promotional fee paid by United Airlines. United flies more people to Hawaii than any other airline. Nobody knows Hawaii like United. This is a presentation of ABC Sports, recognized around the world as the leader in sports television.